This circular device is called the Cuezcoyahualolli, or that which encircles the parietal lobe. This scalplock ornament was once originally specific to the original Second Age Chichimeca clans of the original Second Age Seven Sister Bands or clans of the Second Age, known as the Ejeja Tonaltiautlajame, the Chicomoztoca, the Coatlajame, the Anahuatlajame, the Anahuaja, Anahua, Nahuatlajame, Nahuake, Nahuaja, or simply Nahua. And later, at the beginning of the Third Age of Ak Tonaltiau, after the original Chichimeca of the Second Age intermingled with the race and clans of the Third Age race in Aztlan, the Cuezcoyahualolli then became worn as well by certain clans among the Third Age race who had come to live with the Chichimeca clans of the Second Age. This scalplock ornament was traditionally worn by passing the braid of a male's piochtli or scalplock braid through the center hole of the Cuezcoyahualolli and pulling the braid through until the ornament was tight up against the scalp at the back of the head, where it was then secured with a scalplock pin we call the Cuezcoyahualolmitl, or for Chichimeca women who do not have the burden of wearing the piochtli or scalplock braid like males, and for men while they wore their ixcoixcoitlaxtli headband, the ties of one's ixcoixcoitlaxtli or animal leather headband was passed through the center hole of the Cuezcoyahualolli and secured with a knot up against the back top of the head over the back portion of the parietal lobe of the brain. Now the colors you see on the back of a Chichimeca's Cuezcoyahualolli is animal skin glue pigment paint made with the pigment from the clay or ochres or crushed stones of one's matrilineal clan's territory, and depending on the colors, the shape of the line that splits the two colors, how the circle is split top or bottom or side to side or diagonally, and which side each color may be on. For a Chichimeca, this clearly expresses and allows other Chichimeca to clearly see and know both which territory and which clan this Chichimeca where was from. Now, stretching forth from the Cuezcoyahualolli is what was once called during the Second Age the Cuezcoyahualolli, the split or forked turkey feathers, which then became in the Third Age of Aztlan the Aztatzontli, or the split or forked heron feathers. This is another aspect of the Cuezcoyahualolli, just like the Cuezcoyahualolli itself, that was once originally specific and worn only by the Second Age clans of Chichimeca of the original Seven Sister Bands of Chicomoztoca or Nahua, and which later was adopted and as well worn by the Third Age race clans of Aztlan who had come to live with the Chichimeca clans of the Second Age in early Third Age pre-conquest Aztlan. The Cuezcoyahualolli, which later became the Aztatzontli in the Third Age of Aztlan, marked a noble Chichimeca of high standing within the tribe whom had earned his or her Cuezcoyahualolli or Aztatzontli double split upright feathers by the accomplishment of at least two significant acts of great courage, great bravery, great selflessness, great self-sacrifice, or of great heroism that were acknowledged by one's whole clan or warrior or medicine society, and by which was made up of either wing feathers or tail feathers, or an assortment of both. Now, this dual split feather device was representative of the tall upright double ears of the Cuezcoyahualolli, the Second Age predecessor of an animal that we know today as the Xitochtli, or grandmother rabbit, whose closest living descendant is the jackrabbit, who in the old stories was said to be the bravest, most courageous, and most selfless of all of the animal nations, whom is said to, during the Second Age of Ejeja Tonaltiau, was not yet a prey animal, but was a large predator animal among many other predator nations of this second age, but gave its people and its nation as a sacrifice for all others when there were more prey animals needed here in Tamawanchan for the second age to continue. It is said that this single animal nation's descendants spread out in the four directions of second age Anahuac or Pangaea, and whose descendants arriving in different places, ecoregions, biospheres, and later on vastly different lands, islands, and continents in the later 3rd, 4th, and 5th ages, evolved into a constellation of vastly different wild game animal nations, such as the Tzihuactitlan, all species of jackrabbit, the Tzihuactitlan, all species of rabbit, the Matzat, all species of deer, the Tlamachasca Matzat, all species of antelope, the Ajaxochi Matzat, all species of elk, the Huajo'o Matzat, all species of moose, the Hue Matzat, all species of horse, the Ishkat, all species of sheep, the Tenzon Matzat, all species of goat, the Hueakech Ishkat, all species of llama, and the Hueakech Matzat, all species of camel. Now, in our culture and tradition, each single upright wing feather in the Aztatzontli was earned by one's accomplishment of a great, although non-violence associated act of bravery, heroism, self-sacrifice, selflessness, great courage, or great spiritual accomplishment that was acknowledged by one's clan, medicine society, or society, like the successful completion of the ceremony of childbirth, or by a significant or great spiritual accomplishment that marked the wearer of having exhibited great strength of heart, or undergone and successfully completed very dangerous or arduous rites of initiations within any of the medicine societies. Now, one's first upright tail feather, on the other hand, was earned through one's participation in armed ceremonial combat, or through the act of protecting or defending one's clan, one's people and lands in armed warfare against Tepopuloani or destroyers. And the type of bird that the upright wing or upright tail feather came from, such as the wing or tail feathers of the heron, the wild turkey, the parrot, the quetzal bird, the raven, the crow, the vulture, the eagle or hawk, depended entirely on one's clan, the particular warrior or medicine society one belonged to or had received this tail or wing feather from, and the nature or caliber of the accomplishment or act that earned this particular wing or tail feather. Now, any and all alterations done to or adornment added to an upright wing feather would show and record what initiations and accomplishments the wearer had undergone or facilitated since earning the wing feather, and the rank, honor, or standing of the wearer within that specific medicine society or clan. And if the wearer of this wing feather was not an initiated member of a medicine society or society, the type of wing feather would then express what type of act earned this wing feather, and thus what medicine society or society was responsible for bestowing this feather upon the wearer. Now, any and all alterations done to or adornment added to an upright tail feather serve to account and record the warrior's various acts of bravery, self-sacrifice, and martial accomplishments during armed ceremonial combat or war, telling if and how many times the warrior had been wounded in combat, how many times a warrior had counted coup, how many times a warrior had successfully defended his piochtli from being grasped, how many wars or battles a warrior had taken part in, and if a warrior had killed Tepopuloani or destroyers, and if so, how many. Now, before one had earned one's second upright wing or tail feather, this single feather was worn in one's Cuezcoyahualolli, upright, straight and towards the sky on one's Cuezcoyahualolli. And in many of our second age clan's customs, if the wearer had committed a single act seen as dishonor by one's clan, warrior, or medicine society that awarded the wing or tail feather, the wearer was then burdened to wear the wing or tail feather now sideways, pointing outwards away from the left side of the back of one's head. Now, if the wearer, through an act of honor, humility, selflessness, service, and self-sacrifice, made the dishonorable act right in whatever way was seen fit by the affected party or parties, and by one's clan or warrior or medicine society, the feather was then allowed to be turned facing right, outward from the right side of one's head. And it would take yet another second act of self-sacrifice and selflessness towards the affected party or parties to be able to wear one's earned wing feather or tail feather upright once again. Now, for the earning and wearing of a second upright wing or tail feather to make up the complete Cuezcoyahualolli or Aztaxelli, marking one as a noble Chichimecatzin, a Chichimecatl Tzihuactitlan or Tehuactitlan, a male or female of noble standing, respect, and holding. This took yet another second great act of bravery, self-sacrifice, selflessness, great courage, or heroism that was once again acknowledged by one's whole clan, society, or the whole tribe, like the completion of a second successful ceremony of childbirth for women, or by yet another significant or great spiritual accomplishment, or by the successful completion of the second stage of further, yet more demanding, more difficult, or dangerous, or arduous rites of initiations into any of the various medicine societies, or earned by great and extraordinary acts of heroism, bravery, strength, or courage during a warrior's second willing participation in ceremonial armed combat, or earned during battle by warriors who participated in their second war party that had engaged in all-out armed warfare or combat with Te Poploani in defense of his or her clan, his or her people, and lands. Now, after the earning of the second feather by a Chichimecatl, and thus the earning of the Cuezcoyahualolli or Aztaxelli ornament by a Chichimecatl, there was a large public ceremony and festival known as the Cuezcoyahualolli or the Aztaxelli, the public ceremonial event where this new split feather device called the Cuezcoyahualolli or the Aztaxelli, made from one's Cuezcoyahualolli and one's two earned feathers, was then bestowed, marking a female in each postli, now a Tzihuactitlan, a reverent lady, and for a male, a Piochketl or Okichtli, becoming now a Teochsintli, a reverent lord, a female and male who could now sit and be heard at the Huetlatol Tlehuilitzin, the reverent council fire among the elders. Now, this very specific type of scalplock ornament was originally called the Aztatzontli, which means the heron hair parietal lobe ornament, and was known in the later Mexica diaspora's dialects as simply the Aztatzontli, the heron hair. And before the colonial trade period in the Americas of the 18th and 19th century, and before Buffalo Bill's Wild West shows created sacrilegious powwow culture, this very particular sacred and earned scalplock ornament was originally worn only by proven, veteran, initiated members of Kwachike or Shorn One Warrior societies, which were distinct and specific to only the descendants of the original seven sister bands of Second Age blooded peoples of Chicomoztoc, the Chicomoztoca, the Ejecatunalteotlajame, the race of the Wind Sun, or the Coatlajame, the Serpent People, or the Anahuatlajame, or the Anahuake, or the Anahua, which means the people of Anahuac, which was actually the Second Age world's land formation that was a single large continent and landmass known by Western scholars today as Pangaea. The Nahuake, the Nahuatlajame, or simply the Nahua, which actually means those associated with the four-directional cross and the sacred number four. The descendants of the people whom during the Third Age of Atl Tonaltiao, After leaving Chicomoztoc, returning to the surface of the earth after a great wind and shifting of lands had ended the second age of Ejeja Tonaltiao, found themselves on a string of islands we called Aztlan, or the place of the crowned herons, whom, during the third age, after their enslavement and colonization, along with the race of the third age, the Atl-Tonaltiautlachame, the race of the water sun, also known as the Osomatlachame, the monkey people, the aboriginal native population of third age Aztlan or Atlantis, by the Kinemetsin Waitlachame giants, whose matrilineal descendants then became, depending on one's blood and matrilineal race or admixture, became part of either the military nobility caste, the priest nobility caste, the royal nobility caste, or the slave and soldier caste of the third age civilization that would become known as the Azteca, who modern scholars would understand as the Atlantean. Now the Aztatzontli, or the Aztatzontli, the scalplock ornament exhibited in many pre-Columbian codices seen worn most notably by Lord Tlalochtzin or Tlaloc, whose name means the reverent elixir of earth, the divine masculine principle of water, which is sky water, kiahuit, or rain, and as well notably worn by Lord Tepostehatzin or Tepostehat, whose name means he who dwells within metals, whom was the divine principle of copper, bronze, iron, and of metalworking, and of all smithcraft, whom was the same as the Greek demigod Hephaestus, the Roman demigod Vulcan, the Sumerian demigod Gibel, and the Hebrew demigod Tubal-Cain. Unfortunately, this reverent, sacred, ancient scalplock ornament's description and classification, although recorded in a few early French and Spanish codices, has been miscategorized and misidentified with a very different type of heron-feathered cap headdress that was a cap, not a wreath or a rosette, and was made up of Aztatzontli, white heron tail and wing feathers, and Quetzalcoatl, green quetzal wing and tail feathers, not Aztatzontli, which is a word specifically used to classify and describe only heron silk feathers, which are the long, thin, silky, stringy hair type of feathers that have the likeness of tzontli, or hair, and not ilhuit, or feathers. The cause for this confusion is derived by a compound issue of Western academics' loose grasp of pre-Columbian metaphor, vernacular and language, and the fact that both of these head ornaments are seen commonly worn at the same time by both Tlalochtzin and Tepostehatzin in many illustrations. But only one of these head ornaments can be described as a wreath and not a cap, and being made from Aztatzontli, or heron silk feathers, not Aztatzontli, heron tail feathers and wing feathers, and Quetzalcoatl, quetzal wing and tail feathers. This misidentification, unfortunately, is just one of thousands of other misdescriptions, misunderstandings, and linguistic misrecordings of pre-contact ornaments, weapons, instruments, words, and concepts. One of the more blatant and easily distinguishable examples being the Amitlat, the water arrow or harpoon sender or thrower, misrecorded by Catholic scribes in post-contact Spanish codices as simply the Atlat, which would mean the water sender or water thrower, which would be found completely unintelligible by any traditional language-speaking person in the context Westerners or Americans are trying to use it in. Same with the term Tlasohamati, which is a completely different topic for a different time. Now, this very particular type of scalplock ornament worn underneath a Kwachike Ware Society member's Cuezcoyahualolli belongs to and came into fruition during the Third Age by this very diaspora's elite Ware societies known as the Kwachike, while we were at war with the giants in the Third Age world's lands of Aztlan, and literally means the crowned heron's hair, and was earned and only worn on the back crown of the head underneath a Cuachique warrior's Cuezcoyahualolli on the scalplocks or on the back of one's Ixcoihuetlaxtli or leather headband by proven veteran members of the Cuachique warrior societies, and signified that one had engaged in ceremonial combat or outright war at least three times and had successfully defended one's scalplock braid from being touched or counted coup on or grasped by the members of the opposition during at least three conflicts since initiation as a Cuachique, which had their own specific rites of initiations in and of itself. One must understand that the Second Age clans of the original Cuachique warrior societies, warrior culture during that time and earlier was based on three flightless birds, the Aztec, the ancient Second Age crown heron of Anahuac, who had survived the end of the Second Age and whom were the most common heron present in the Third Age lands of Aztlan that our people had named the lands after, the Huexolotl, the ancient Second Age turkey, and the Huanahatl, the ancient red jungle fowl. And all of our Second Age race clans' male custom, tradition, aesthetic, culture, courtship customs, courtship dances, regalia, war dances, war medicine, and warrior culture and arts of the martial nature originally came from these three flightless warrior birds, the Aztatzin, the crowned heron, the Huexolotzin, the ancient wild turkey, and the Huanahatzin, the ancient wild red jungle fowl. And as you'll come to find, there is only one very specific species and genus of heron that dons the very particular type of crest that the Third Age's Cuachique warrior society member's scalplock ornament, the Aztatzontli or the Aztatzonhuescopili, is mimicking. That the scattered remnants of the descendants of the original Cuachique warrior society of Aztlan spread throughout all across the Americas kept the custom and tradition of making and adoring their piochtli or scalplock with, that was once unique and specific to only this diaspora and their 4th and 5th ages Rh negative and haplogroup X Moundbuilder lineages and warrior societies descendants. And the only two surviving 5th age descendants of the ancient original Aztec, the ancient crowned crane or crowned heron that Aztlan was named after and that this scalplock ornament is mimicking, belong to the Balearica genus and are known by Western scholars as the gray crowned crane and the black crowned crane, which are only found in the modern day wetlands of the Sahara Desert of Northern Africa, which one must understand during the Third Age of Atl-Tonaltiao would have been part of the eastern territories of ancient Aztlan and its very particular formation of lands, which were known to my peoples as a series of long east to west stretching islands and satellite islands that stretched across the Third Age's eastern to western equatorial longitude across the Ilhuija Atlantic or the Atlantic Ocean. Now, what one has to understand is that the poles shift at the very end of each 27,000 year age in sequence with the procession of the equinox. And because of this, the equator of the Third Age is now the 33rd northern parallel of the Fifth Age. Aztlan or Atlantis was a land formation particular and specific to only the Third Age of Atl-Tonaltiao, the water sun, which was an age that lasted between the time of around 78,000 years ago to around 51,000 years ago, not 11,000 years ago, as Western scholars would mislead you to believe, but 78,000 years ago until 51,000 years ago. This was the actual time that the civilization of Aztlan or Atlantis actually existed, proof that this tradition and the original diaspora whom created and donned this scalplock ornament, mimicking this very specific type of heron, predated the America's modern formation of land masses, and as well predated this continent's diaspora of 4th Age Cro-Magnon population, whose genesis began in the 4th Age, and whom would have never seen a crowned heron, which are only found in the Saharan wetlands of modern-day Northern Africa. Now, this ceremonial scalplock device, specific to this genetic and cultural diaspora, was never worn on the top of the head like a baseball cap, nor kept on the head by tying strings to either side of the device and tying them underneath the chin, like seen exemplified in popular Hollywood Western or quote-unquote Native American themed movies, and in the sacrilege, unfortunately exemplified by powwow dancers who unknowingly propagate the Wild Westing sacrilegious powwow clown culture created by Buffalo Bill in his Indian exploitation Wild West rodeo shows, where it seems most Americans and non-traditional, non-language speaking members of our population unfortunately seem to derive and base all of their skewed, warped, perverse, misguided education, views, perceptions, or misunderstandings about this land's indigenous cultures, traditions, customs, and histories from. This sacred and urn scalplock ornament was traditionally and only worn on the back crown of the head after the braid of a male's piochtli or genithlake scalplock braid had been passed through the center of the ornament, and it was secured to the back parietal lobe area of the skull with a scalplock pin that we call the Cuezcoyahualolmitl. Or, if one was wearing an Ixcoixcoitlaxtli, or an enamel leather headband, the two laces of this headband was passed through the center of the Aztatzontli, then through the center of the Cuezcoyahualolli, and then pulled tight to the back upper part of the head over the back of the parietal lobe of the skull, and then knotted. The Aztatzontli traditionally was a wreath or slightly bowl-shaped rosette made from Aztatzontli or heron silk feathers, primarily from the crowned heron's crest hair and the heron's neck and chest silk feathers, and secondarily from the guard fur of three different animals, the guard hair of the tlalcoyotl, the badger, to give one ferocity, tenacity, and virility in battle, the guard hair of the huitztochtli, the porcupine, to give one scalplock braid protection medicine or invulnerability during battle, and thirdly, the red ochre dyed white tail hair of the matzak, the white-tailed deer, to give one's head nimbleness, agility, speed, and an intuitive sense for danger during combat. And depending on the wearer, the Aztatzontli could as well include the guard hair of the mistli, the panther, the coyote, the coyote, the ixtehat, the bighorn sheep, the tochtli, the rabbit, the tlajame tequani, the bear, and even human or giant hair. So your next question may be, how did this original diaspora of Second Age clans, whom were the progenitors of the Coachique war societies of Third Age Aztlan, donning this very specific type of scalplock ornament, imitating a particular type of heron whose modern-day descendants are only found in the Saharan wetlands of Northern Africa, come to be found by the early Spanish, French, and British colonists in the Americas, and more curiously, in only certain regions and among certain tribes, spread all around North America and Mexico, all speaking different languages, but all sharing very distinct cultural, architectural, social, religious, genetic, and phenotypical traits distinct to populations of diasporas around the world associated with Rh negative blood and the haplogroup X. According to the old songs and oral history, when this third age of Atl Tonaltiao was coming to an end by way of a great flood and a great shifting of lands, it is said that during the chaos and cataclysm of both the Great War, between the eagle and serpent clan of giants and the great deluge sinking Aztlan, a myriad of peoples had been able to escape the stone cities of Aztlan and flee through a cave system into a place in the inner earth that we know as Chicomoztoc. And this very specific diaspora of Azteca or Aztlanechi or Atlantean refugees whom had made it into the inner earth before Aztlan had sunk, many, many generations later, in the fourth age of Xioquiahuic Tonaltiao, meaning the son of rain of fire, re-emerged from Chicomoztoc and returned to the surface of the earth and found themselves in a place that we call Tzihuactitlan, in the valley of the Grand Canyon, dead center in the middle of a new tall-shaped formation of continental landmass known today as the Americas. And throughout of the whole next 26,000 year fourth age, while at war with the surviving giants whose arcs and fleet had landed on the western coast of South America, whom we called the Olmeca, either became recaptured again and brought south into the stone cities as slave, human cattle, or sacrifice, or avoided recapture and re-enslavement, fleeing from the mouth of Chicomoztoc into the high desert cliff dwellings to establish and build high vantage point fortified structures in a place we know of in the old songs and stories as Colhuacan, which are the fortified stone cliff dwellings in modern day Cañon de Chelly, whom my clans knew as Chochayan, which means the place of weeping, where our ancestors lived for a time and were known as Colhuaca, which means the people of Colhuacan, or the grandfather people. For many generations, the root people and culture of the descendants of whom Westerners refer to as the Anasazi people. Our people became trapped and sieged in this place by the Kinametzin, Huetla, Jame, Olmeca giants and their armies for thousands of years. And during this time, many peoples and clans, one by one, fled Colhuacan or Chochayan in different waves. The group of Azteca peoples of Colhuacan in the fourth age of Xioquiahuitl Tonaltiao, whom were the first to leave Colhuacan, leaving behind the other Colhuaca of Colhuacan and the Colhuacayot, the survival siege culture historians refer to as the Anasazi culture, did so to flee Colhuacan or Chochayan in the midst of the war with the giants, because it is said that certain descendants from the Teopixque priest and Teteuchtin royal-blooded clans of Aztlan, whom had escaped into Chicomoztoc at the end of the Third Age, whom carried pure copper or serpent blood from their matrilineal lineage of the Ejeja Tonaltiautlajame, the race of the Second Age, and the patrilineal lineages of the Ocelo Tonaltiautlajame, the race of the First Age, the race of the giants, whom we knew as the Kinametzin Huetlajame giant kings of Aztlan, began to use their cleverness, their sorcery, and knowledge of astronomy, eugenics, cosmology, astrology, geomancy, alchemy, herbalism, divination, evocation, and the whole of the Kinametzin Huetlajame's dark arts and sciences to once again beguile, enchant, bewitch, disempower, exploit, and take control of the Third Age clans and mixed-blooded clans once again, and began to manipulate and re-enslave the people, reimposing and reinforcing social stratification, the Masehuali caste system, and re-began the human sacrifices and Huitzilopochtli or Baal worship once again during this Fourth Age in Colhuacan, as well as the practice of cannibalism, eating the members of the Masehuali caste and their children, as was customary for the Kinametzin Huetlajame giant kings and nobility of Aztlan and their descendants. The first wave of clans to leave Colhuacan soon after leaving, it was said, split into two main groups, both attempting to return to their original Second Age and early Third Age hunter-gatherer and fishing way of life. but still at war and still while living as guerrilla refugees and warriors fighting against the Olmeca, Kinemetsin-Huitlacame giants and their armies, whom were have said to have come from the south, spreading from the basin of the Amazon up through Panama into the Valley of Mexico and then far into North America for the whole of this fourth age. One of the main diasporas that were part of the first groups that left Colhuacan were led by a number of clans from the Ejeja Tonalteautlajame, the race of the wind sun, or the Coatlajame, the serpent people, also known as the Nahua Nahuake or Nahuatlajame, which actually means those associated with the four-directional cross and the keepers of the sacred number four. The clans of this group that were the first to leave was made up of primarily members and families from the clans of the Chichimeja, which means those who live among the wild dogs, from the root words Chichime, which means dog plural, and Jatl, specifying a person of, Ja being a plural formation, who were known distinctly from the other seven original clans of Second Age Nahuatlajame or Nahua by the large amount of wild dogs that commonly lived in their villages among them, as well as their unmatched proficiency with both the making and the use of the Tlahuitoli y Juanmitl, the bow and arrow. The other most notable Second Age clan that made up this group was the Malinalha, the people of the vines, whom were known by their incredible vine weaving tradition and known to make much of their things from woven vines. Both of these Second Age clans of Nahua, hunter-gatherers and warriors, were associated with the creation and proficient use of the Tlahuitoli y Juanmitl, the bow and arrow, and basket weaving cultures, and had dwelled in the agave and yucca rich high elevations of pine woodland and oak forest lands of central Aztlan during the Third Age, and after a 1,000 year war against the invading Kinemetsin-Huitlacame giants and their ancestors' inevitable colonization, were conquered and colonized and forcibly, culturally and genetically assimilated into the newly forming Azteca or Aztlanechi or Atlantean civilization of the Third Age in Aztlan. Now, it is known in our old songs and stories and records kept within our clan systems that after these clans' colonization during the Third Age in Aztlan, the Second Age copper-blooded women of our Second Age clans were forcibly made into breeding stock for the Kinemetsin-Huitlacame giant kings because of our Second Age clan's copper-based, non-iron-based blood, which is a very specific type of blood shared only by the race of the Second Age and the invading race of the Kinemetsin-Huitlacame giants. And it is said in our oral history that the firstborn sons of these giant kings and our Second Age women were kept and raised as royalty in the Tlatoanjali and Neteojjali, the royal palaces, and groomed in the Calmejac to become the future Tlatoani and god kings of Aztlan. These firstborn sons' lineage and descendants would make up the foundational lineage of the royal kingship bloodlines and god kings of every empire from this moment on and each age after. The second-born child was as well kept in the Tlatoanjali and the Teojjali royal houses and palaces and schooled in the Calmejac, but then at a young age was sent to live in the Teojjali or the ashram or spirit house with any one of the various Teopixque priest orders depending on his genethleics, where he would soon after puberty be initiated into and taught the sciences, the dark arts, astronomy, astrology, cosmology, alchemy, geomancy, eugenics, metallurgy, herbalism, mysticism, magic, divination, evocation, and any of the ancient occult esoteric crafts belonging to his respective priesthood or lodge or house of initiation that were present in the Third Age's ancient Kinemetsin-Huitlacame giants mystery schools of Aztlan or Atlantis. These second-born sons or widow's sons lineage would then make up the lineage of the noble priest classes of ancient Aztlan called the Teopixque, and would later become the foundational royal lineages of the infamous priest kings of empires around the world from this moment on. The third-born son was as well initially raised in the royal houses, but was sent off at an early age to the Tlahochcalmejac, the school of knighthood, where he would be trained extensively and arduously in every aspect of the arts of war and initiated into one of the many knighthood orders based upon his matrilineal clans and his early martial accomplishments, where he would be groomed to be a Tlahochcalque, a royal knight of Aztlan, and live with his respective order in a section of the royal courts known as the Tlahochcalco, a territory of the palace grounds reserved only for the Tlahochcalque royal knight orders, whose living quarters was situated around the Tlahochcalcintli, the sacred house of darts, the kingdom's sacred and holy armory. These third-born sons' descendants became the foundational, hereditary, noble lineage of the Tlahochcalca, or the Tlahochcalque, military nobility caste of Aztlan, along with the original conscripted Second Age race or Nahua warrior societies, whose descendants made up the other half of the first generational foundational bloodline of royal knights of ancient Aztlan, whom were the Coachique, the Xornwan warrior society knights, the Cuaoque, the Eagle Warrior Society Knights, or those whom carry the Eagle Bone Whistle, the Xiocoyolque, the Turquoise Coyote or Fire Coyote Warrior Society Knights, and the Oseloque, the Jaguar Warrior Society Knights. Now, back to the initial exodus of Colhuacan in the Fourth Age. So, this diaspora within the first initial group to leave Colhuacan, made up of a mixed number of members from the Chichimeca and Malinalca clans, descending from this military nobility caste of the Tlahochcalque, and a number descending from the Teopixque priest class, were said to be a number of the Nahuali sorcerers and sages from the Tlachixque medicine society, those who are said to unyieldingly gaze, the Tlahatecoloque Medicine Society, the Aumen, whom were known to be shapeshifters, the Tle Tlachixque Medicine Society, the Firegazers, said to divine by staring into fire, the Tlehuil Ixpianque, the Guardians of the Hearth Fire, which were a society of orators and wisdom keepers, the Seotlan Teitanque Medicine Society, those who divine through rendered animal fat, the matriarchal Mejatlapoque Medicine Society of string diviners, the Tlamatinque Medicine Society, an order of wise men of sages, and a large group of Tlakekelotzinque, the sacred mockers or reverent fools, a trickster society descending from the original order of ancient Atlantean royal court jesters. And with them followed a large amount of clans of the descendants of the Third Age race of Atl, Tonaltiao, or Osomatlachame, whom my clans knew as the Kwaitlilzinha, the reverent black-headed or black-haired ones, the clans of the aboriginal race of Aztlan or Atlantis, which were made up of the soldiers, hunters, farmers, miners, builders, and craftspeople from the slave caste of Aztlan. Now, this diaspora took with them the seeds of the Kinametzin Huetlachame giant Atlantean slave classes, human and animal cattle gruel, which had allowed the Colhuaca to survive the sieges of the giants, which were the many variants of elotli or corn, many varieties of et or beans, many varieties of ayotli or squash, and the tlalchomotli or sweet potato, and the potlat or potato, and as well took them with many domesticated fruit seeds of Aztlan, like the chichijayotl or watermelon, the ilamatzapotl or apple, the papayatl or papaya, and a few others. And then all collectively fled Colhuacan, but would remain
in the Four Corners region and in the southwestern territories of North America and Mexico. In the modern states like that of Utah, Nevada, Colorado, New Mexico, California, Arizona, Texas, and Mexico, where they would intermingle with the local Fourth Age race peoples of these territories and whose descendants became the Rh negative and haplogroup X blooded, light skinned, green hazel or blue eyed, copper haired diaspora and clans among the peoples known today in the Fifth Age as the tribes of the Uto-Aztecan language speaking diaspora of the Nahua, the Paiute, Comanche, Ute, Pima, Huichol, Tongva, Cahuaisu, Cahuila, Tataviam, Westermanu, the Taumara, the Shoshone, the Yaqui, and the Tohono O'odham. The Tongva were initially part of this group, but after many generations of longing for their Matlatzinha clan's original fishing culture that defined their coastal clan's lifeways and cultures in ages past, later migrated to the coast of California, following the trails and villages left behind by their own clan's members that fled to the west coast when they left Colhuacan. Now the other group, whom was the other half of the first wave of clans of Colhuaca to leave Colhuacan, were a diaspora that was as well led by the clans of the Ejeja Tonalteautlajame, the race of the Wind Sun, or the Coatlajame, the serpent people known as the Nahua. But this other group was primarily made up of a number of members and families from the clan of the Matlatzinha, the Reverent People of the Fishnet, the Chalha, the Greenstone People, and the Tepaneja, the people whom live in places made from stacked stones, which were nearly all Second Age clans of Nahua whom lived on the northern coast of Aztlan as fishing people, associated with the continued use of the Amitlat, the water dart thrower, whom after the 1,000-year war with the invading Kinametsin Huitlajame giants and their ancestors' subsequent enslavement, their patrilineal lines became the foundational lineages of the noble royal naval military caste of Aztlan, known as the mighty Achalchimalteirke, the lords of the shield boatmen, the captains of the vanguard war and exploratory fleets of Aztlan or Atlantis, while mixed-blooded members of their clans of mixed third and second age blood became the Achalpochtejake, the sea traders. While these second age clans' matrilineal lines were forcibly interloped with the giant kings of Aztlan and their descendants born into the highest ranks of lords, kings, and hereditary Teopishke priest classes and caste of Aztlan. It is said that soon after leaving Colhuacan, this diaspora and these clans split from the other original Uto-Aztecan language-speaking clans of the Malinalcha and the Chichimeca and fled west, seeking the coast until they arrived on the Pacific coast of modern-day California. It is said that these three clans then intermingled with the local indigenous Fourth Age peoples whom were there already living on the coast of California, and their descendants then became the Rh negative and haplogroup X blooded, light skinned, green hazel or blue eyed, copper haired clans of the California coastal Uto Aztecan, Panutian, Hokan, Yukon, and Algonquin language speaking peoples like the Tongva, the Pomo, the Yurok, the Chumash, the Gabrieleno, the Miwok, and a few others. It is said that many generations later, though, a small number of clans from this group, after receiving visions to travel back east to the Grand Canyon to find the cave that led back to Chicomoztoc, the inner earth that their ancestors had come from, and guard it until the end of the Fifth Age, left the Pacific coast of California and arrived in the territories alongside a number of their original Uto-Aztecan language-speaking sister clans of the Chichimeca, whose descendants later became the Paiute, and settled along the Colorado River in the Grand Canyon area, bringing the coastal human language with them, and became the Yavapai, the Havasupai, and the Hualapai. Now, back to the California coast. It is said in the old songs and old stories that during this fourth age, some generations later, that some of the large second age and mixed second and third age blooded clans whose ancestors were once upon a time the highest ranks of Aztlan's naval military nobles, astronomers, sea traders, and boat architects and builders began building sailless Achalchimali warships similar to the ones that their ancestors had built in the third age in the lands of Aztlan. It is said that some of these groups then began taking their Achalchimali ships and migrating by way of water up the Pacific coast north into the northwestern territories as far as the Yucatan Bay, interloping with the Fourth Age indigenous peoples of those territories and creating the Fourth Age cultures whose descendants who remained in those territories would later in the Fifth Age become and make up the Rh negative, haplogroup X blooded, light skinned, copper hair, blue, green, or hazel eyed clans and populations among the Tlingit, the Haida, the Tsimshian, the Northern Huachiotl, the Balakula, the Southern Huachiotl, the Nanchanutl or Nutka, the Salish, the Kelehui Chimacum, the Qualhiokwa, and Chinook-speaking coastal peoples of the northwest coast. Now, it is told in the old songs that the second wave of peoples to leave Colhuacan fled far southeast and was made up of a very large group of second age pure copper-blooded clans of the Chichimeca, almost all of the Ahuexotzinca, which means the reverent people of the White Willows, and a very large amount of the clans of the Tepaneca. It is said that the clans that left during this wave were mostly the descendants of the Third Age Azteca Empire's rebel mixed-blood giant Tetilchtin lords or nobles, Teopishke priests, and close to three-quarters of the entire Coachique War Society's descendants, whom were challenging the authority of the new self-appointed priest kings of Colhuacan and chose to leave Colhuacan in the middle of the war with the giants and take their chances on their own. When this group was preparing to leave, seeing the corruption and darkness beginning to take hold in Colhuacan, many mixed second and third age blooded clans left with them. It is said when this large diaspora left Colhuacan, they as well took with them the seeds of the Kinametzin, Huetla, Khame, Giants, Atlantean slave classes, Masehuali, and livestock gruel, which had allowed the Colhuaca to survive the thousand-year sieges of the Giants, which were the many variants of elotli, or corn, many variety of etl, or beans, and many variants of ayotli, or squash, as well as the tlalchomotli, sweet potato, and the potlat, or potato, and as well took with them many domesticated fruit seeds of ancient Aztlan, like the chichichayotl, or watermelon, the ilamatzapotl, or apple, the papayatl, or papaya, the alaxoxtli, or orange, and a few others, and then chose which direction to migrate towards under the traditional guidance of the Chichimeca clan Second Age Medicine Society called the Champa Huau Chau Yaoke, the Direction Stick Diviners, whose sacred direction stick carrier threw a sacred directional stick to divine which direction they should take to receive safe passage, avoiding the Olmeca giants and their armies and scouts, and to be able to have access to ample shelter, nourishment, and wild game along the way. It is said when the stick landed, it was divine that they must leave and go in the direction of the southeast until they found the ocean. If they were to survive the giants' armies and scouts, and the hardships of this coming long and arduous journey. It is said that along the way, they encountered a number of rogue, deserter Olmeca giants and had to fight on more than a few occasions, but on many occasions were offered support in battle and received food, lodging, furs, clothing, and supplies from a number of the Chichimeca clans who were in the modern-day states of New Mexico and Texas, who recognized them as long-separated members of their own clans and warrior societies, whom had left Colhuacan many generations before them, which allowed the second wave of Colhuaca refugees to continue their journey southeast for many years until they arrived in a territory near the border of Texas and Louisiana at the Gulf of Mexico coastline. The old stories say that this group then followed the coast of the Gulf of Mexico into Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, and Florida, and then interloped with the local Fourth Age race peoples to become the ancestors of the Fifth Age tribes known today, belonging to the Muskogean language-speaking diaspora, like the Chickasa, the Choctaw, the Cree, the Miccosukee, the Atahapa, the Seminole, the Tamaqua, the Chitimacha, the Nachas, the Alabama, etc. And those who continued their migration further north and east, following the Gulf of Mexico coastline until reaching the Atlantic coastline, then followed the Atlantic coastline northwards, and then interloping with local Fourth Age race peoples and leaving settlements and group behind in the territories known today as Georgia, the Carolinas, Virginia, and Pennsylvania, before settling in the Great Lakes territories of modern-day New York, Ohio, Indiana, Michigan, Illinois, and Wisconsin. This diaspora and their settlements left behind in the states along the Atlantic coast would later in the Fifth Age became known as the tribes of the Iroquoian language-speaking family, like the Cahuilla, the Cherokee, the Huron, the Mohawk, the Tuscarora, the Oneida, the Onondaga, and Seneca. And those who still continued their migration even further north and then west, following the coastlines of the Great Lakes inland, and then interloped with those local Fourth Age race peoples, became the Fifth Age tribes of the Algonquin language-speaking diasporas, like the Northern Cree, the Ojibwa, the Blackfoot, the Arapaho, the Sac and Fox, the Mi'kmaq, the Cheyenne, the Lenape, the Pequot, the Delaware, the Narragansett, the Shawnee, the Wampanoag, etc. And through intermarriage, their clans and specific Rh-negative blood type, haplogroup X, and culture, custom, tradition, medicine, and war societies also spread into the neighboring Siouan and Caddo language-speaking diaspora and peoples. It is said that the third wave of peoples or clans to leave Colhuacan many, many generations and millennia later, in the Fifth Age, were said to be a large group of members from the Cuitlahuaca, the Chalca, the Tepaneca, and Xochimilca clans, who had for many generations, while in Colhuacan, mixed with the clans of the Third Age race. It is said that this diaspora as well took with them the seeds of the Kinametsin, Huitlahame giants, Atlantean slaves, Masehuali, and domesticated animal gruel, which had allowed the Colhuaca to survive the sieges of the giants of the Fourth Age, which were the many variants of elotli, or corn, many varieties of etl, or bean, many varieties of ayotli, or squash, and the tlalhamotli, sweet potato, and potlat, or potato, as well took with them seeds from some of the domesticated fruits of Aztlan, like the many variants of the chichihayotl, or watermelon, and the ilamatzapotl, or apple. These peoples' Fifth Age descendants then became the Puebloan peoples of the Southwest and Mexico, whose descendants founded the modern-day pueblos of the Ajoma, the Zuni, the Cochiti, the Isleta, the Yemes, Laguna, Nambe, Okeowinge, Picuris, Pohuaque, Sandia, San Felipe, San Ildefonso, Santa Ana, Santa Clara, Santo Domingo, Taos Tezuque, Enzia, and many others. It is said that some many, many generations later, that the same members of these clans, whom had stayed behind in Colhuacan, eventually leaving hundreds of years later, then became the peoples known today as the Hopi, whom are said to be the very second of the last peoples to leave Colhuacan or Chochayan. Now, the very last group to leave Colhuacan or Chochayan, according to our songs and oral history, were the last remaining members of the clans of the Chichimeca, the Chalca, the Cuitlahuaca, the Tepaneja, the Malinalja, the Xochimilja, and the Huexotzinja, whom were devout followers of a man whose lineage came from a matrilineal Nahua clan of Chichimeja, who were believed to be direct patrilineal descendants of Tlatoansin Patlateuxin, patriarch of the Eagle clan of giants, one of the two primary patriarch giant god king leaders of the two opposing factions of immortal giant god king bloodlines of Aztlan, whom was of pure copper blood from his first age, Kinamesin Huetlajame patrilineal lineage's giant blood, and his second age, Nahua matrilineal serpent blood. It is said that this man was born many heads taller than even all of his very tall clan members and had bright red hair, supernatural powers, an elongated skull much more elongated than his own clan members, was the greatest warrior of Colhuacan, and was rumored to have had six fingers and six toes like his giant god king's patrilineal forefathers, and was said to have lived for many hundreds of years. This man was known to our clans as a prophet and devout devotee of Huitzilopochtli, and this man was known as Teuxin Mexixin, or our Reverend Lord Mexich. His name meaning figuratively portal of or for the moon. Lord Mexich was believed by his followers and even by my clans to be the incarnative descended avatar of the demigod Huitzilopochtli, whom the Greeks knew as Ares, the Romans knew as Mars, whom the Sumerians knew as Marduk, whom the Babylonians knew as Baal, and whom the Norse knew as Thor. It was Lord Mexich and the followers of Mexich who became known as the Mexica, the people of Mexixin. This is the true meaning and origination for the etymology and name for this actual diaspora who were the last to leave Colhuacan, the Mexica, who by divine inspiration and visions led by Lord Mexich began a 100-year migration southwards from Colhuacan at Canyon de Chelly into the Valley of Mexico, where they arrived in a place that would become known as Tenochtitlan, the city among the paddle cactus fruit, in the 14th century, where he and his army would overthrow the current occupying Tolteca royal kingship bloodlines and nobility, where then he and his royal descendants and children would then interlope with the Tolteca royal women and take control of the Tolteca kingdom, empire, and slave and soldier caste, and establish the Altepetl Mexica, the city and kingdom of Lord Mexich, and soon after, his descendants established the Eshchan Tlatoloyan, the Triple Alliance Empire. This is the reason why all of these very specific cultures and tribes, from the Uto-Aztecan language-speaking branches to the Haida, Pomo, Salish, Muskogean, Iroquoian, and Algonquin language-speaking branches, as well as the Siouan and the Caddo language-speaking branches, found throughout the continent by the time of the arrival of the Spanish, French, and British, all specifically and distinctly share the same Second Age cultural, oral, and genetic links, as well as the cultural scars and genetic remnants left behind by the Third Age Kinemesin Huetlajame giant occupied Aztlan and the Azteca or Aztlanechi or Atlantean civilization. This is as well the reason and root for the headboarding and headbinding tradition among some of this diaspora's descendants to attempt to elongate the skull to either manufacture or accentuate phenotypical features specific to the Kinemetsin Huetlajame giant race and their descendants, whom were the nobility of Aztlan, whom had naturally elongated skulls. So, whom were the Tolteca, whom the Mexica encountered in Tenochtitlan and overthrew their kingdom? And how are the Tolteca as well genetically and culturally related to Aztlan or Atlantis? The Tolteca, before they arrived in Tolan, or the place of reeds in modern-day Tula, Mexico, used to be known as the Tlapalteca, whom came from a land far to the east called Tlapalan, who were once Azteca themselves, the descendants of an Azteca or Aztlanechi or Atlantean king, whom my clans knew as Lord Tzihuitz, whom was known by his Tolteca descendants as Nota, whose fleet of arks escaped the sinking islands of Aztlan, and at the beginning of the Fourth Age had landed in a territory known today as the Levant, among the mountains of Mount Ararat, whose various descendants then spread throughout, colonized and interloped with the Fourth Age's white-skinned diaspora of Cro-Magnon peoples, women of the caves of the Caucasus Mountains and the Levant, whose royal descendants became the kingship bloodlines, royalty, and ruling elite of the Proto-Sumerian and Sumerian Empire, and later the Phoenician, the Sanskrit-speaking Vedic Aryan or Mauryan Empire, the Minoan Empire, the Akkadian Empire, and its later formations of the Canaanite and Chaldean or Babylonian empires, and all others that descended from these empires in the later epochs, such as the Greek, Roman, Persian, and the Greco-Roman occupied period of the Kemetic or Egyptian Empire, such as Alexandria and the Ptolemaic Kingdom. This particular diaspora were not able to escape back to the caves that led to Chicomoztoc, the inner earth during the Great Deluge, had survived the Great Flood by being taken on board a particular fleet of many Hueachali, the Kinametsin-Huitlachame giant kings had built to survive the Great Deluge, specifically members of the central and northern coastal clans of the Matlatzinha, a seafaring fishing people who made up the military naval nobility and sea traders of Aztlan, the Tepaneja, those known to live in stacked stones, the Chalcha, the green stone people, and members of a central Aztlan group known as the Chichimeja, those who live among the dogs, who were taken on the fleet of Hueachaltin, belonging to a giant king said to live in the central northern coastal territories of Aztlan, that our people knew as Tzihuitzin, who was of the eagle clan of giants, and who was said to have been known by his great patience, who was a devout devotee of the demigod Mishkoatl Khamashtli, whom the Greeks knew as Zeus, the Romans knew as Jupiter, whom the Sumerians knew as Enlil, whom the Egyptians knew as Amen, whom the Norse knew as Odin, Wotan, Gut, or God, and whom the Jews knew as Yahweh, or El. Tzihuitzin was also referred to as Nota, which means my father, in the Nahuatlatoli language, by Tolteca Empire descendants, diasporas in Mexico, whom recounted the flood story in Nahuatlatoli in the Fifth Age after their colonization by the Mexica. The Sumerians knew this king Tzihuitz as Ziusudra, the Babylonians knew him as Utnapushtim, and modern man familiar with the Abrahamic character derived from this historical figure and giant king know him as Noah, who was just one of the many Aztlanechtlatoantzintzin, or reverent Atlantean kings, whom had built great arks and filled them with their seven priesthood orders, their families, their wives and consorts, their slaves, soldiers, seeds, and livestock, and escaped and survived the great flood that ended the Third Age. And when the floodwaters of the Third Age subsided, had in the beginning of the Fourth Age landed in various different regions all across the world. Now, it is said that Lord Tzihuitzin, or Nota, was warned of the Great Flood by his devotionary demigod, Mishkoatl. And it is said that King Nota's fleet of arks at the beginning of the Fourth Age landed among the mountain ranges of Mount Ararat in the Levant, where the kingship giant bloodlines and nobility of Lord Tzihuitzin, or Nota, and his clan and armies then enslaved the members of a new primitive Fourth Age race that was present in the caves of the Levant that we knew as the Xiuquiahuitl-Tonaltiautlachame, also known as the Michtlachame, or the fish people, whom modern scholars may know as the white-skinned diaspora of the race of the Cro-Magnon of the Caucasus, and established the Fourth Age kingdom that the site of Gobekli Tepe is an architectural remnant of, which was actually founded around 40,000 to 50,000 years ago, and not 12,000. Upon first contact during the early colonization period, the red and blonde-haired giant royalty blood nobles of King Nota and their hybrid second age and third age blood military army and naval caste, taken as slaves from Aztlan, interloped with hundreds of thousands of these fourth age white-skinned Cro-magnon cave women of the Levant, leaving oceans of fatherless, mixed-race, giant, second-age, third-age, and fourth-age blooded children in their wake, and then began their eugenic breeding programs on this population of early human found in the caves of what would later become Europe, and began the purposeful and forcefully imposed genetic synthesis of this particular white-skinned fourth-age Cro-Magnon diaspora with the slaves that they had brought with them, our third age brothers and sisters, whom we knew as the At-Tonalteotlachame, the race of the water sun, also known as the Osomatlachame, the monkey people, also known to us as the Kwaitlil-Tsingha, the reverent black-headed, meaning black-haired ones, whom were the aboriginal early human population of the Third Age and Aztlan, or Atlantis, whom modern scholars may know as the direct descendants of the Neanderthal, thus creating new and varying breeds of human cattle with a deeper gene pool and with varying favorable physiological traits desired for the varying lower castes of their new empire in the Levant, such as the toilers, builders, soldiers, miners, farmers, prostitutes, slaves, sacrificial offerings, food, and servants of the Fourth Age's Proto-Sumerian, Proto-Phoenician, Proto-Vedic Aryan or Marian civilization and its caste system. The genetic and cultural remnants of this diaspora and varying lineages brought from Aztlan or Atlantis descendants became the Rh negative and haplogroup X diasporas among the Sanskrit-speaking Aryan, the Celtic, the Pictish, Sumerian, Phoenician, Minoan, Akkadian, Canaanite, Babylonian, Proto-Aryan, and Proto-Semitic root culture and peoples whose genetic, linguistic, and cultural remnants can still be found in certain ancient lineages among the oldest indigenous populations of Rh negative or haplogroup X peoples living in the modern day states of Palestine, Iran, Romania, Serbia, Turkey, Armenia, Syria, Assyria or Persia, northern India, northern Africa, Morocco, Pakistan, Lebanon, Ireland, Scotland, Wales, Sardinia, Mongolia, Nepal, Tibet, Poland, Norway, Belarus, Ukraine, Denmark, Finland, France, Greece, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, Norway, Egypt, Libya, Iraq, Algeria, Spain, Italy, Portugal, Russia, Japan, Germany, Kazakhstan, Afghanistan, Turkmenistan, Siberia, and in the Athabascan and Sahaptian speaking peoples of the Americas, as well as the Tlapalteca or Tolteca descendants of Mexico and the Americas. So, where from, how, and when did the Tolteca arrive here? It is said that the homeland of the Tolteca or Tlapalteca was a place we call Tlapalan, meaning the place of the red people, which was a territory located on the Mediterranean coast of the southern Levant, which modern Western academics would call ancient Phoenicia, from the first millennium BC Greek term meaning the place of the red people, which included the modern-day states of Israel, Lebanon, and parts of Syria, which were as well lands of the later Canaanite, Babylonian, and Persian empires. It is said that a fleet of Tlapalteca ships owned by a Tlapalteca giant king, along with seven giant-blooded priest kings of Tlapalan and their noble families, priests, military nobility, and vast warships of armies and slaves, arrived on the eastern shores of the Valley of Mexico in search for the western remnants of their ancient Third Age homeland of Aztlan or Atlantis, by way of the Ilhuica-Atlantic, or the Atlantic Ocean, and the Gulf of Mexico, arriving in the Gulf of Mexico coast of Veracruz between 3,500 and 3,300 years ago, after losing a great war and being driven to the sea by another warring faction of giant nobility, whom was said to have invaded Tlapalan from the south. The Tlapalteca arrived in the Valley of Mexico between 3,500 and 3,300 years ago, not 1,200 to 1,300 years ago, as Western imperial scholars, scribes, and historians would mislead one to believe. One must understand that the original date count of the Tonalpohualli has been purposefully misrepresented by Western academics, and the timeline and the history of the arrival of the Tlapalteca or Tolteca contained in codices such as the Amoxtli Chimalpajin were written by descendants of lineages of compromised and initiated members of European secret societies whom were given the promise of status, wealth, and holdings to obfuscate and alter our people's history for the benefit of their benefactors, which were at the time the Spanish Catholic monarchy and the secret societies that operate through this institution. Scribes like Don Domingo Hernandez Ayopochtzin and his grandson Chimalpajin, who wrote the Amoxtli Chimalpajin and others to conceal and obscure the true timelines and true history of the so-called New World, to fit the clandestine agenda and perception-warping narratives manufactured and controlled by certain ancient bloodlines and the occult secret societies and fraternal orders whom serve them. This is the true reason why virtually all of the post-contact codices drafted by colonial-sponsored scribes and historians like Chimalpajin all contradict one another, as well as contradict all of the pre-Columbian Amoxtli and all of the traditional oral history of the indigenous populations of the aforementioned territories, because all of these literary historical works are falsities. This is as well why the original language branch that was being spoken at Colhuacan was the Aztecan branch of the Uto-Aztecan language family, which is a proto-Semitic language that was the shared language family of all Colhuaca before the splitting of this group and the migrations and intermixing of this diaspora with the races of the Fourth Age, whom all spoke different languages specific to their regions and their own respective migrations. The purest remnants of this root Azteca or Atlantean language that was being spoken in Aztlan or Atlantis are found most strongly in the dialects of classical Nahuatlatoli and Hebrew. The reason why both of these languages are so similar. For instance, in classical Nahuatlatoli, the word for I is ni. In Hebrew, the word for I is ani. The word for you in classical Nahuatlatoli is ti. In Hebrew, ata. And for a comparative example, in a spoken phrase, how I would say the phrase, now I understand, in classical Nahuatlatoli, I would say, Ashkan nimati. In Hebrew, how I would say, now I understand, is, Achshav animevi. As well, this is the reason why the Cherokee word for God is Yohehwa, similar to the Hebrew Yehovah and Yahweh. As well, why the Hebrew word Yehovah is the same as the classical Nahuatlatoli, Teyohwa, which is a compound word made from the root words teot, which means spirit, and yohua, which means to fill up, making teyohua literally mean that which fills us up with spirit. And why the Hebrew word for their god, Yahweh, which is the same god as the Egyptian Amen, the Sumerian Enlil, the Greek Zeus, the Norse Odin, and the Roman Jupiter, and the Aztec Mishkoatl, is as well the same word used in the classical dialects of Nahuatlatoli to refer to Mishkoatl or Jupiter as Yahweh, which is a compound word from the root word Yahweh, which means a seemingly never-ending travel, and is as well an allegorical term for a type of mystical flying journeyer, and the word Hue, which means great. Making Yahweh means the great or ancient mystical eternal traveler or journeyer. This is as well the reason why Mi'kmaq hieroglyphics are so closely related to ancient Kemetic or Egyptian hieroglyphics, and the reason why the chief of the Nez Perce tribe of Montana, Chief Joseph, was captured by Americans with a clay tablet in his medicine bag, which Chief Joseph said had been handed down to him through ancient times by his own clan's ancestors for hundreds of generations. And on the clay tablet was an ancient cuneiform writing that could be translated using the Sumerian cipher. This is because the Sumerian, Akkadian, Assyrian, Persian, Chaldean, and Babylonian cuneiform systems, and the Egyptian or Kemetic, Aztec, Mayan, Olmeca, and Mi'kmaq hieroglyphics or ideogram systems all came from the same root cuneiform and glyph systems that were established and used as the lingua franca in ancient Aztlan or Atlantis. So after the Tlapalteca arrived on the eastern coast of Veracruz and became the Tolteca, they overthrew the royalty of the current colonial occupation, which was the giant nobility of the Mayani, whom you may know of today as the Maya or Mayans, and forcibly interloped with their royal women and ladies of the Mayani court, as well as the Second Age blooded priestesses, and intermixed the royal Tolteca bloodlines with that of the royal bloodlines of the Mayani, and took control of their population, slaves, soldiers, kingdoms, tributaries, and empire. Now the Maya, or the Mayani as we knew them, which means those who unceasingly hunger, or the greedy, according to our oral history and songs, their ancestors' empires' expeditionary fleets had begun arriving from the west on the Pacific coast of North America and Central America in waves, beginning around 13,000 years ago, and had come from the Pacific Ocean, from a land far west in the territories known today as Southeast Asia, Southern India, and East Asia, and had rediscovered and rebuilt the abandoned 3rd and 4th age stone pyramids and cities left behind by the Olmeca giant kings, whom virtually all had perished at the end of the 4th age of Xiuquiahuitl-Tonaltiao, which was the age that was ended by a great rain of fire, a cataclysmic comet event that triggered volcano eruptions that occurred around 26,000 years ago, not 13,000 years ago as academics would mislead you to believe, but around 26,000 years ago, which triggered volcanoes to erupt and wiped out the Olmeca giants' civilization that had been spread throughout South, North, and Central America during the Fourth Age, but was destroyed 26,000 years ago. The Mayani giant kings' fleets, whom arrived on the Pacific coast of Guatemala, then re-enslaved and recolonized the local surviving 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and new 5th age peoples. And in the coming generations, their slaves, servants, and soldiers they brought with them interloped, intermarried, and synthesized with the surviving 4th, 5th, and 3rd age lineages, and even lineages of the rebel 2nd age priest class, and the first age blooded half-breed Olmeca giant king descendants, whom had survived the end of the fourth age by taking refuge in a cave system that led to Chicomoztoc, the inner earth, and had returned to the surface of the earth, but had remained in the forest, jungles, and lands of the Yucatan and the Valley of Mexico. The Mayani then reoccupied these stone cities and kingdoms left behind by the Olmeca and forced its new slave caste to continue the rebuilding of the stone pyramids and stone cities of ancient Third Age Western Aztlan that were still in Mexico and the Yucatan, and between 13,000 and 8,000 years ago established a new large imperial branch of the Southern Indian, Southeast Asian, Proto-Dravidian, Proto-Tamil, Proto-Khmer, Proto-Champa root culture, and founded the Mayani or Maya Empire of the Americas between 13,000 and 8,000 years ago, whose ancestors were as well once Azteca, Aztlanechi, or Atlanteans themselves. The descendants of a people who were ruled by a southern coastal Third Age Azteca or Aztlanechi or Atlantean giant king of a kingdom that had occupied a large southern coastal region of Aztlan, whom we knew as Melahuac Tlatoansin from the Serpent Clan of Giants, who is said to have been known for always speaking truthfully, who is known by the ancient Aryan Sanskrit Vedic text of the Shatapatha Brahmana as Manu. Now it is said that this southern coastal Aztlanechi king, Melahuac Tlatoansin, was a devout devotee of a demigod, whom we knew as Tlalochtsin or Tlaloch, whom the Mayani knew as Chach, whom the Vedic Aryans knew as Matsya, whom the Sumerians knew as Enki, and the Babylonians as Ea. And like all other surviving giant kings of Aztlan, Melahuac Tlatoansin was warned by his own respective demigod of devotion and was told to construct a great weyachali or ark and brought with him on it members of his own royal bloodlines and various descendants, representative members of the seven main Second Age blooded Teopishke or priesthood orders and clans and their families, all of his livestock, all of his agricultural seeds, including elotli or corn, a number of soldiers, servants, wives, consorts, and slaves, and his weyachali or great ark, according to the ancient Vedic texts and our oral history, after the floodwaters had subsided, is said to have landed in the Malay Mountains in the Fourth Age, which is said to be the Western Ghats on the western coast of southern India, on the coast of the Arabian Sea. And after he landed in the Malay Mountains in the Fourth Age, he then colonized the local Fourth Age indigenous population that was present on the western coast of southern India and created the Fourth Age Empire and culture that would eventually colonize, interlope, conquer, and spread across virtually all of the lands of the Indian Ocean and create the Fourth Age Empire, whose cultural, architectural, and genetic remnants still existed in the Fifth Age's empires, kingdoms, royal bloodlines of the Fifth Age's southern Indian Dravidians, the Tamil and the Southeast Asian and southern Indian kingdoms royalty, priest and military nobility bloodlines remaining in the territories known today as southern India, Cambodia, Myanmar, Burma, Thailand, the Philippines, Vietnam, Singapore, Indonesia, and Malaysia, like that of the Tamil Empire, the Dravidian Empire, the Khmer Empire, the Champa Empire, and others, whose cultural and genetic remnants still remain among the oldest lineages of the indigenous peoples of Southeast Asia, like the Dayak, the Ifugao, the Bontoc, the Dusun Lotud, the Ilongot, the Iban, the Murut, the Barawan, the Naga, the Kalinga, the Sagari Igorot, the Apayao, the Konyak, the Mapurondo, the Hmong, the Karen, Aka, Lahua, Lisu, Yao, Pilung, and many other tribal groups of Southeast Asia and southern Indian peoples of the Kannadiga, Malayali, Tulu, Tamil, and Telugu and Punjabi peoples whose ancestry have high Rh negative blooded populations from both the race of the Second Age and the giants that were the nobility of Aztlan, as well as high numbers from the haplogroup R, which was the race of the Third Age, the aboriginal population of Aztlan or Atlantis. Now, this Fourth Age, Proto-Dravidian, Proto-Khmer, Proto-Tamil, Proto-Champa root civilization and empire was the civilization and empire whose fleets, sometime close to halfway through the Fifth Age, which was about 13,000 years ago, began traveling in waves to the Americas by way of the Pacific Ocean and rediscovered the abandoned pyramids and stone cities of the Olmeca giant kings in the Fourth Age that their empire had rebuilt, reoccupied, and subsequently left behind in Mexico and Central and South America after their civilization was destroyed by a rain of fire or comets that had ended the Fourth Age. These people became known to us as the Mayani, who then recolonized the surviving members of the Second, Third, and Fourth and Fifth Age races of the territory and became the progenitors of the Fifth Age's Mayan kingdom and empire. This is as well the reason and root for the headboarding and headbinding tradition among this diaspora's descendants. Now, it is said that another Weyakhali that escaped and survived the Great Flood was the ark of a royal prince of Aztlan, whom was the second-born son of Atlatehxin. This giant prince was named Topilsin Hualhuahuitzin, or Our Reverent Prince Nourishing Tree, or Good Tree, whose patrilineal lineage was of the serpent clan of giants and whose matrilineal lineage was of the eagle clan of giants. This was the same giant prince who would later lead our people in the rebellion against his father and his own giant race and free our people during the great war of the giants that was occurring in Aztlan while Aztlan was sinking, whom was the actual original founder of the authentic ancient Third Age Great White Brotherhood of Aztlan or Atlantis and its various mystery schools, fraternal orders, or medicine societies safeguarded by the Second Age priesthoods of the Rishis, Nagas, Nahuas, or Nahuali, whom it is told after his crucifixion in sinking Aztlan after being captured during the rebellion, creating a distraction so that our people could escape the stone cities of Aztlan and flee back into Chicomoztoc, and his subsequent resurrection 3 days later as the Third Age was ending, later became known as Topiltzin Quetzalcoatzin, Our Reverent Prince the Feathered Serpent, or the Reverent Ascended One, who after his crucifixion became the divine archetype known as Quetzalcoatzin, the Reverent One who shed his dense scales to grow feathers, our linguistic and cultural allegory for the greatest act of distillation or ascension, the metamorphosis from one's very lowest state to one's highest or perfected state, whose perfected or evolved archetype then replaced one of the four divine archetypes we know as Xipetotexin, the flayed one, or he who shed his skin, the divine archetype of rebirth and renewal, and became one of the primary four cardinal archetypes of Ometeotzin that dwell in the second to highest 12th realm of the heavens of Topan that we call Ilhuicatl de Teohan. It is said that after his resurrection, he escaped sinking Aztlan in a great ark accompanied by a small number of royal naval ships with seven representatives of each of the seven priesthood orders of Aztlan and their families and extended families, a number of both noble naval and land military nobles and soldiers loyal to him from the heartland capital of Aztlan, all of his livestock and all of his agricultural seeds and fruit seeds, which included xochoetl, the bitter bean known today as the cocoa bean, used to make xochoatl or chocolate. And it is said when the floodwater subsided at the beginning of the Fourth Age and his small fleet's journey concluded, his ark and fleet landed in the territory of what is known today as the Nile Valley region of Africa, where he was navigated to by the Belt of Orion and the shining single tip of one of the great pyramids of eastern Aztlan that remained above water, whom he was very familiar with. After his fleet landed in the Nile Valley region of Africa, it is said that he then colonized the Fourth Age race diaspora of black-skinned Cro-Magnon indigenous population present in the Nile Valley region, whose skin was said to have turned black from remaining on the surface of the earth and not in the caves like their white-skinned Cro-Magnon counterparts of the Levant and Central Asia during a solar event that occurred during the precessionary period of the equinox between the time that the Third Age was ending and the Fourth Age was beginning, unsheltered. And after some generations of having males from his mixed half-second age-blooded, half-giant-blooded priest caste coalesce with the hand-picked finest daughters of this Fourth Age race's black-skinned Cro-Magnon indigenous population of the Nile Valley region, there began to be women born among this new Nile Valley diaspora with copper or Rh-negative blood, which could be divined by the keen and discerning perception of the Tletlachishke, or fire gazers, by taking a woman's menstrual blood and pouring it over a very hot, small-sticked fire and watching the way that the fire was altered by the blood in color, in shape, in sound, in resonance, in heat, and in flicker, in contrast to when given known pure copper blood or known pure iron blood, as well was clearly discerned by way of certain distinct physiological phenotypical features belonging to the race of the Second Age, like copper or reddish colored hair, green or hazel eyes, an eye condition described as center heterochromia, an index toe substantially longer than one's hallux or big toe, extra lumbar vertebrae, extra ribs, and sometimes extra bones in the lower legs. The women who tested positive for copper blood or Rh negative blood were then intermarried within the priest caste, becoming high priestesses of the Fourth Age's Proto-Kemetic, Proto-Egyptian Empire, and then their Rh-negative daughters, whom were the descendants of the black-skinned Fourth Age race of the Nile Valley region's indigenous population, and the Second Age priest caste of Aztlan, whose blood had been mixed with the giants since early Aztlan, began then being intermarried into the royal Kinemetsin Huitlahame giant god-king bloodlines of ancient Aztlan, whose descendants and clans then created the Fourth Age's Proto-Kemetic or Proto-Egyptian Empire's original tall, elongated-skulled, light-eyed, black-skinned, copper or red-haired Rh-negative royal kingship, priest, and priestess nobility castes of ancient Kemet, and the cultural, genetic, linguistic fusion and synthesis of Second Age race, custom, tradition, clans, and bloodlines, Third Age race of ancient Aztlan or Atlantis, clans, tradition, culture, customs, and bloodlines, Kinemetsin Huitlahame giant kings of Aztlan, tradition, customs, culture, and bloodlines, and the Fourth Age indigenous race of the Nile Valley regions of Africa's custom, tradition, clans, and bloodlines, which would create the linguistic, genetic, cultural phenomenon and root culture, noble bloodlines, empire, and peoples that would become the progenitor of the Kemetic or Egyptian Empire, where our Topilsin Kwalkwahuitzin or Topilsin Quetzalcoatzin became known as Thoth or Tehuti. This diaspora's genetic and cultural remnants and bloodlines from the Fourth Age original Proto-Kemetic Proto-Egyptian Empire, which existed between 50,000 and 26,000 years ago, before a great rain of fire ended the Fourth Age and ended this original Proto-Egyptian Empire, can be found surviving into this late Fifth Age in the bloodlines and clans among the Nilotic, Nubian, and Somali language-speaking indigenous tribes of Kenya, Tanzania, Darfur, Uganda, Ethiopia, and Sudan, like that of the Maasai, the Turkana, Datoga, the Kalenjin, the Nuer, the Luo and Dinka, the Kenzi, the Faricha, the Sukhot, the Samburu, the Mahas, the Sonjo, and the Danagla, as well as the Somali, Ja'alin, and the Shagia, and others. This is as well the reason and root for the headboarding and headbinding tradition among this diaspora's descendants, to attempt to elongate the skull to either manufacture or accentuate certain phenotypical features specific to the Kinemetsin Huitlahame giant race of ruling class and nobility whom had naturally elongated skulls. It is said that during the time between 40,000 and 26,000 years ago, the opposing faction of giants of the Eagle Clan, the descendants of King Nota or Tzihuactitlan, whose arcs had landed in and colonized the Levant and the white-skinned diaspora of Fourth Age Cro-Magnon, began warring with the opposing Serpent Clan faction and royal giant bloodlines in control of the Nile Valley in an attempt to reclaim the prized remaining Atlantean Tlatepetlalili or stone pyramids of Eastern Aztlan, known today as the Great Pyramids of Giza. These back-and-forth wars, counter-occupations, and cross-colonizations of the 4th and 5th age in Mesopotamia and Northern Africa between the royal giant kingship bloodlines of Eagle Clan of Giants of the Levant and the royal kingship bloodlines of the Serpent Clans of the Nile Valley that were taking place from around 45,000 years ago up until around 2,000 years ago is said to be what created the unique bloodlines, diasporas, cultures, and lineages among the modern-day Bedouins, the Saharan nomads, and the Arabic or Middle Eastern diaspora, including the seafaring northern migrating Druids of Wales, Ireland, and Scotland, and the Gypsies of the Mediterranean, Europe, India, and Asia. During this Fourth Age as well, during the Great Wars, many people from the same diaspora of the Nile Valley were said to have fled from the Nile Valley region from the Fourth Age's Proto-Kemetic Empire far west and far, far south, becoming refugees, and for many, many, many generations, commingling with the Fourth Age races' indigenous populations of Western and Southern Africa, and formed the ancestors of some of the tribal groups of modern-day Namibia, Niger, Nigeria, and Angola. Groups like the Wodabe, the Himba, the Igbo, the Yoruba, and others. Another Third Age Azteca, or Aztlanechi-Atlantean king, who is said to have escaped the great deluge that ended the Third Age, was said to be a king of a western highland territory of Aztlan, whom we knew as Manco Xapatzingha, who was a descendant of both the Eagle and Serpent Clan of the Giants, who is said to have been known by his ability to snap his fingers and create things out of thin air, whom the Incans knew as Manco Capac. Now it is said that this highland Aztlanechi king, Manco Capac Singha, was another devotee of a demigod whom we knew as Tlalochtzin or Tlaloch, who the Maya knew as Chach. And like the other surviving giant kings of Aztlan, Manco Capac Singha was warned by his own respective demigod of devotion, Tlalochtzin, and was told to construct a great weachali or ark and brought with him on it his descendants and representative members of the seven main Second Age Blooded Teopishke or priesthood orders and clans and their families, all of his livestock, all of his agricultural seeds, including elotli or corn, and shochoet, the bitter bean known today as the cocoa bean, used to make shochoat or chocolate, a vast number of his soldiers, servants, wives, consorts, and slaves. And his fleet of weachali, or great arks, according to ancient oral history and songs, after the floodwaters had subsided, landed in the Andean mountain ranges of Lake Titicaca between modern-day Bolivia and Peru. And after he landed, it is said that he and his ships full of Azteca, or Aztlanechi, or Atlantean giants, mixed Second Age naval nobility and elite military nobility, servants, slaves, lords, priests, then conquered, colonized, and interloped with the local Fourth Age indigenous populations of Cro-Magnon women that were present on the Pacific coastal highlands of South America in areas known today as Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, Chile, and Argentina, and created the Fourth Age's actual ancient Olmeca empire and culture around 50,000 years ago that would eventually conquer, colonize, and spread across virtually all of the Pacific coast of Central and South America, and then spread east into the Amazon basin, and then spread north up into Panama, and then into the Valley of Mexico, and then far into North America, attempting to expand his empire across the whole of the Americas and reclaim the whole of the stone cities that were left of Aztlan in the Americas, and enslave or re-enslave its indigenous populations to rebuild the Tlatepetlalili pyramids of Western Aztlan or Atlantis that were remaining. Near the end of this Fourth Age, it is said there was a large rebellion and a small diaspora of the enslaved population of the Olmeca in the Amazon basin were able to break free and fled the stone cities and the Olmeca Empire's tributary villages northeast out of Brazil into the northern Atlantic coast of Guyana, Suriname, and Venezuela, where they lived for a time. Before a few generations, a number of this diaspora split and left this territory by way of canoe off of the North Atlantic coast of Venezuela into the lands of Trinidad, where this diaspora, after some generations, began then island hopping by way of canoe through the Caribbean islands of the Lesser Antilles up into Puerto Rico, the Dominican Republic, Haiti, Jamaica, Cuba, and the Bahamas. Some even made it as far as southern Florida, where they were absolved or synthesized into the local indigenous populations of the Southeast. Now, this diaspora and the genetic, linguistic, and cultural remnants they left behind in the North Atlantic coast of Guyana, Suriname, and Venezuela, and on the Caribbean islands of the Lesser and Greater Antilles would become the Taino and Arawak peoples. Now, for the populations, lineages whom were not able to flee South and Central America, the most notable living remnants and scattered descendants of this diaspora of Central and South America in the Fifth Age became the Incans, and can still be found among the haplogroup X, fair skin, fair hair, green, blue, and hazel-eyed populations of the Orocanu, the Chachapoya, blonde-headed cloud people of the Andes, the Kuna, peoples of Panama, and other indigenous tribes still living in the forests and jungles of the Amazon and Southern and Central America. The famous red-haired elongated skulls found in Peru, called the Paracas skulls, are some of the Fourth Age remnants of direct descendants of these royal bloodlines of Manco Capac Sinja that arrived in Peru 50,000 years ago. This is as well the reason and root for the headboarding and headbinding tradition among this diaspora's descendants to attempt to elongate the skull to either manufacture or accentuate certain phenotypical features specific to the Kinametsin, Huitlahame giant race ruling class and nobility and their descendants whom had naturally elongated skulls. One important note, the giant stone heads classified by clueless Western scholars as the Olmeca heads are not from the actual Olmeca civilization, but were created by a completely different diaspora an entire age later by one of the many groups of initial rogue exploratory fleets of the Southern Indian, Southeast Asian, Proto-Tamil, Proto-Khmer, Proto-Polynesian, Proto-Champa, Proto-Dravidian, Proto-Maori, Proto-Mayan Empire that arrived in the Valley of Mexico after island hopping through the Australasian and Polynesian islands. This is the reason why all of the Olmeca head statues are wearing a variant of the Polynesian Mahioli war helmet and are only around 5,000 years old, which are about 30,000 to 50,000 years younger than the actual authentic Olmeca civilization of the Fourth Age. But the Polynesian islands have a much older history with the remnants of Aztlan and the authentic Olmeca of the Fourth Age. It is said in the old songs that many, many generations after Manco Capac Sinja's fleet of arks and naval ships had first landed on the South American Pacific coast 50,000 years ago, that around 26,000 years later, just before the Fourth Age was ended by a great rain of fire, two groups of Olmeca were able to flee Olan. The first group was led by the rebel elders, matriarchs, and patriarchs from part of two large pure copper-blooded giant and second age lineage clans of Teopixque priests and a large number of mixed blood second age and third age lineage clans whose ancestors were once part of the Azteca elite naval force of Aztlan and later the elite Olmeca naval force of Olan and descendants of the original seven sister bands of Chicomoztoc or Nahua, primarily the clans of the Matlatzinca, the reverent people of the fishnet, the Tepaneca, those who lived in stacked stones, the Chichimeca, those who live among dogs, and the Chalca, the green stone people clans. And the other group was led by a small number of Kinametsin Huitlahame Olmeca giant kings, royal families, priests loyal to the kingship bloodlines along with their families, their slaves, and their soldiers. It is said that both groups filled their fleet of ships with agricultural seeds and the tlalhomotli or sweet potato, potlat or potato, the manilatzapotl or mango, the alaxoxtli or orange, the matzatli or pineapple, the huaxilotl or banana, along with the huanajatl and totolin, domesticated jungle fowl and turkey livestock, food stores, weapons, precious stones, and tlatohuahuitzin, talking sticks, and an even number of men and women, and left the coast of Peru escaping the cataclysm that would end the Olmeca Empire close to 26 to 27,000 years ago, and sailed their small fleets of Ajal Chimali naval warships west into the Pacific, where these two different groups landed in Easter Island, where they warred for many centuries, and then in the next generations spread out all over into Tahiti, then to Teholau, and then the Cook Islands, then to Nui, Samoa, Tonga, Tuvalu, Fiji, Vanuatu, New Zealand, Nauru, the Solomon Islands, and Hawaii. This was the ancestors of the two main opposing factions of tall, copper-haired, fair-skinned, swirling pattern tattooed, red-painted diaspora that the Southeast Asian Maori encountered on the eastern, southern, and northern islands of Polynesia and Hawaii upon their arrival. This is the source for the Rh negative and haplogroup X, tall, copper-haired, blonde-haired, red-haired, fair-skinned, green, blue, or hazel-eyed gene and diaspora and clans among the oldest native lineages of the Maori and Polynesian peoples, like that of the Ehu people, the...
This is my dad, grandmother, Hawaiian Indian, my grandfather. His mother was a Waratini. And the Waratini grandmother was red-headed, and she had the green eyes. And she was a very, very fair lady.
The Pati Pai Arehi, the Ngati Torehu, the Urukehu, the Karioi, the Kahuimanga, and many others as well.
And that DNA was sent to America to be analyzed. And it proved that we were of Ngāti Hotu, and every bit of the history I gave at the Waitangi tribunals was correct word to word. And my DNA,
we came straight to Germany, into Russia, after being driven in
America, among the Inca people,
slaves and soldiers loyal to the giant kings of Olan. This is the true reason behind the cultural and genetic links that ties these earliest Rh negative clans of Polynesia to the oldest clans and lineages of
ancient
fair-skinned,
old tiki,
light-eyed and light-haired.
So the tiki is not a Maori emblem.
X-blooded
people. It belonged to the Ngāti Hotu
America,
people.
Peru,
and Mexico is
Bolivia,
in my DNA.
Ecuador, the Amazon, Mexico, the southwestern U.S., the Pacific Northwest, the Great Lakes Territory of the Americas, the northern and eastern woodlands of the United States, and as well as the Levant, Persia, Egypt, Iran, Turkey, Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, Morocco, Lebanon, northern India, Ireland, Scotland, Wales, Eastern Europe, Germany, and Japan, etc. Because all of these regions' indigenous populations' oldest lineages were present in Aztlan during the colonization of Aztlan by the Kinamesin-Huetlajame giants during the Third Age, while living in Aztlan or Atlantis, and even before Aztlan, shared a genetic and cultural and clan root specific to their diaspora that predated even Third Age Aztlan or Atlantis and the whole of the Third Age, whom before Aztlan all lived in the Second Age as Anahuaca or Anahua or Nahuaca or Nahua, whose people or race's genesis occurred during the Second Age of Ehecatunaltiau, the Wind Sun. The descendants of the Coatlajame, the Serpent People, whose ancestors were said to have evolved from the surviving serpents that had survived the end of the First Age of Ocelotunaltiau, the Jaguar Sun, also known by modern scholars as the Age of the Dinosaurs, whose bipedal and humanoid genesis occurred an entire age before the genesis of the Third Age's modern mammalian primate strata that the races of the Third, Fourth, and Fifth Ages had all evolved through at some point of their evolutionary process towards bipedal human being. And this is the true reason and explanation for what has puzzled mainstream Western academics for centuries on the phenomenon of Rh negative blood and its origin and haplogroup X and the haplogroup X and Rh negative blood type being found exclusively among the descendants of these diasporas in the Fifth Age and being found only in certain diasporas from very certain regions and certain clans in the Americas to certain clans in Polynesia, Indonesia, Hawaii, Southeast Asia, Japan, to the Levant, Sardinia, Mesopotamia, Northern India, Iran, Egypt, Syria, Morocco, Persia, Ethiopia, Kenya, West Africa, Europe, and Central Asia, separated by entire oceans, but connected directly through our shared ancient history, cultura, customs, cosmology, tradition, language, religion, symbolism, and blood, which share the Tlatepetlaliliot, or pyramid or mound builder culture, the Tehuatlachnol Ichniotón, traditional stickball game, Malinal Ikitilistli, or vine weaving, Nachaz Hoyatlalistli, or ceremonial ear stretching, Yachapiloli, or nose ornamentation, Chichiltich Depospitzkiot, or copperwork, the Amitlat, harpoon or dart thrower, the Tlachalhuas Quahuit, or reed blow dart gun, the Itzmahuahuit, the obsidian baited war club, or any variants, the Tlato Hualhuitzin, or talking sticks, the Depospitzkiot, or metallurgy, the Piochtli or scalplock or genith leg braid, Quachique Shornwon Warrior Societies, the Malmejat or captive rope, shorn heads with scalplocks, the Huau Ololi, the ball headed war club, the Tilmatli or cape worn under the armpit of one arm and over the shoulder of another, the Aztatzontli, a very specific type of scalplock ornament based upon the crest of a bird that is not native to the Americas, the Ajali, the reed boat, the Ajal Chimali, the shield boat or war boat, the custom and tradition of covering one's whole body in Tlapalzintli or Cocohuay, red ochre and animal grease paint, burying one's dead painted in Tlapalzintli, red ochre paint, Ikitilisiot, a specific type of textile weaving and patterns, the Ilhuitilmatli, the feather cape, known as the Ahu'ula by the Polynesians, the Huehuet log drum, known to the Polynesians as the Pahuhula, the Teponaztli slit drum, known by the Polynesians as the Pate, the Kwaish Tlachopiloli, the center forehead dangle, which is the male equivalent to the Vedic Aryan or Hindi Mangtika, which used to be worn by both men and women, the Cuezcoyahualolli, the scalplock or crown hair plate drop, which is the male equivalent to the modern-day Vedic or Hindi Jedi Bilai, the Tohaitlahuiloli, tattoo culture and heavily tattooed bodies and faces, Elotli or corn, the Tetlatejoni, the carved stone axe, the Chichiltich Huatepostlatejoni or copper or bronze-headed axes, the Teohuitlatan Huapili or gold teeth caps, the Pamitl or sacrificial war banner, known to the samurai of Japan as the Nobori or Sashimono, the Yei Sich Nyoton, the three sister corn, beans, and squash agricultural practices, Shochoet or the cocoa bean, the Kwatlatochli planting stick, and Huanachat, domesticated jungle fowl, the Huayahuaochaltzintli, the wooden longhouse, the Matzatli, the pineapple, the Papayat or papaya, the Tlalchomotli or sweet potato, and Potla, the potato, the Tonalpohuayotl or astrology, the Sitlatlachianyotl or astronomy, the Tlahuiloliotl, hieroglyphic writing systems, Te Tlachishinkiotl, stone carving culture, Te Tzotzonkiotl or stone masonry, records of ancient antediluvian history in stories and songs, the Kikistli or blowing shellhorn, the Tlatoan Mechayot, the Teoch Mechayot, Nitlachochkalke Mechayot, and Teopishke Mechayot, concepts of hereditary chiefs, hereditary war chiefs, and hereditary priest clans, a strong importance on the Chalpol Mechayot and the Ez Mechayot clan systems and keeping arduous records of it, Huautlashinkiot, a distinct shared type of wood carving culture, shared symbolism, including most iconically the Mahuil Maitzin, the five-fingered hand, the Xicalcolioqui, the stepped fret symbol, the Axcual Ixtelotli, the evil eye, the Coatzin, the reverent serpent, and the Quetzalcoatzin, the Huehuecoatzin, Nicoapatlancintli dragon motifs, and the Nenepil Papatlaja Xayajat, or the Yao Nanalja Xayajat, the face with the flaring tongue, or warrior snarling face motif, and clans with light skin, hazel green or blue eyes, copper hair, and with Rh negative blood types from the haplogroup X, and the most common and shared symbolism that all Second Age people have carried with them since the very Second Age, the Nahuitzintli or the Nauhampa, the four-directional Venus cross, and its reverent variant, the Nauololitzintli, most commonly known by the original authentic Sanskrit-speaking Vedic Aryan civilization of Central Asia, the Levant and Northern Africa and Northern India as the Swastik or Swastika. Now, what is the cause for the specific blood type and distinct phenotypical features such as Rh negative blood and golden skin, hazel or green eyes, and copper colored hair, and the distinct peculiar traditions and customs specific to this ancient race and genetic cultural diaspora, such as painting themselves in red ochre paint, the four-way directional cross, and its whirling counterpart, known most commonly in the Sanskrit language as the Swastik or Swastika, the tradition and custom of this race's prayers always facing east towards the morning star or Venus, the customary tradition of removing all of the hair on their bodies and faces, including their eyebrows, except for the hair on their heads for women, and for men, the very distinct practice of removing all of the hair on their bodies, faces, eyebrows, and even the hair on their heads, besides a section of hair left on the top back crown of the head, directly over the parietal lobe of the brain, such as the Chichimecapiochtli, the Aztecatemilotl, the Amazigh Tamzort, the Egyptian Lock of Horus, which had nothing to do with youth as Western academics purport, but had to do with noble or royal blood, and was located on the back right side of the parietal lobe or crown of the head, and braided to fall over the right side of the head and neck to symbolize one's loyalty to only one's patrilineal giant lineage, which correlates with the right masculine side of the body. The Osedelets of the Hun and Cossacks, the Central Asian Bianzi or Q of the Mongolians, Manchu of Central Asia and China, the Vedic Aryan and Brahmin and Dravidian Sika, the scalplocks of the Muskogean, Iroquoian, Siouan, Caddoan, and Algonquin language-speaking peoples, and the scalplocks of the traditional ancient warriors of Borneo, Polynesia, East Asia, Southeast Asia, and Africa. Where does all this come from? First, we will address the phenotypical features and blood type specific to the race of the Second Age. This race of peoples, whom had evolved from the surviving serpents of the First Age, who became bipedal humanoid during the Second Age, were the original seven sister bands of Chicomoztoc, who throughout the ages were known by the later races as the Chicomoztoca, or the people of Seven Cave, or the Coatlajame, the serpent people, the Anahuaca, and the Anahuatlajame, or Anahua, which means the people of Anahuac, or the Nahuake, or the Nahuatlajame, or the Nahua, the people associated, or the keepers of the four-directional cross, or the Nagas, the serpent people, who all once lived in a Second Age paradise and Eden, free from toil, war, or civilization, in a large, single Second Age formation of land known as Anahuac, who modern-day scholars would call Pangaea. It is said during the Second Age, like all other ages, there was a different sun than there was today, a sun that we called Ehejatl Tonaltiao, the wind sun, a sun that was brighter than the sun of the First Age of the Giants, but was much dimmer than the coming suns of the Third, Fourth, and Fifth Ages. Because of this, the race of the Second Age had developed a type of melanin specific to that age's solar and atmospheric conditions, known today by Western science as red-yellow pheomelanin, which creates copper hair on the light mid to dark reddish spectrum, or copper hair on the light mid to dark brown end of the spectrum, and every shade in between. Golden colored skin with a reddish undertone, or golden colored skin with a yellow or olive undertone, hazel or green eyes, and every shade in between, and phenotypical features specific to and as seen exemplified most commonly among the Rh negative and haplogroup X blooded, fair-skinned, fair-haired, green or hazel-eyed phenotypes of Persians, Palestinians, Punjabi, Iranians, Syrians, Northern Indians, Lebanese, Moroccans, American Indians, Peruvians, Bolivians, Mexicans, Ecuadorians, Northern Africans, Turks, Afghanis, Iraqis, Romanians, Central Asians, Polynesians, Jews, Berbers, Japanese, and Mediterranean peoples. So when and why did the tradition of this race of the Second Age, covering their entire bodies in red ochre paint, begin? That has been kept in practice by this Pacific diaspora's descendants and cultural remnants worldwide, from Africa to the Americas to Asia, the Pacific Islands to the Mediterranean and Europe. It is said in our oral history and songs that before a great wind destroyed nearly all of human life on the surface of the earth at the end of the Second Age, that the race of the Second Age, the Chicomoztoc or the Coatlacame, the serpent people or Nahua, were able to escape back into the inner earth, Chicomoztoc, where our ancestors lived for a time. It is said that time passes within the inner earth world much different than how time passes on the surface of the earth world. And when our people's ancestors returned to the surface of the earth, there was now a new sun of this new third age that we called Atl-Tonaltiau, or the water sun, which was a very bright sun, much brighter than the sun that the Nahua had known in their own 27,000 year second age. It is said that this third age's sun was harsh on the skin of the race of the second age when they tried to migrate out of Chicomoztoc to return to their life on the surface of the earth on these islands of Aztlan as once again hunter-gatherers and fisher people. So it is said that the ancestors prayed four times in each of the four sacred directions until our Mother Earth, Tonantzin-Tlaltzin, replied. It is said that Tonantzin-Tlaltzin told our ancestors, the Second Age people, the Coatlacame, or Anahuake, or Nahuake, or Nahua, to cover themselves in the blood of her womb, Tlapaltzintli, before they permanently migrated out from her creation cave, out into the open, tropical, sunny lands of Aztlan. So this they did. Our ancestors then gathered Tlahuit, the red ochre in the earth west of the mouth of Chicomoztoc, and crushed it into a fine red powder that we call Tlaotexintli, and then hunted, harvested, and ate the raw flesh, as was all Second Age clans' traditional way of eating, of the great reverend Sipachtli, the ancient saltwater crocodile, then took the fat of this reverent Sipachtli and in large clam and oyster shells above hot coals of our tlequili or hearth fire, rendered this Sipach Seyot, this crocodile fat, into Sipach Chiawachayot, or crocodile grease or oil, and then took this Sipach Chiawachayot, this rendered crocodile fat, and mixed it with the Tlaotexintli, or crushed red ochre powder, to make the original Second Age race's sacred Tlapaltzintli, the red ochre paint that the Coatlacame, or the Anahuake, or Anahua, or Nahua, those associated with the solar cross, would then paint each other's entire body with before migrating out of the mouth of Chicomoztoc further into the lands of the surface world of the Third Age. And from this time on, these peoples and this race and their descendants and clans descending from the original seven sister bands of the race of the Second Age of Ejecatonaltiau, the Ejecatonaltiautlachame, or the Coatlachame, or Anahuatlachame, or Anahuaca, or Anahua, or Nahuatlachame, or Nahuaque, or Nahua, the serpent-blooded race of the Second Age who left Chicomoztoc and Aztlan, or Atlantis, continued this ancient, customary tradition and ceremonial rite of covering our bodies in the blood of our Mother Earth's womb, the Tlapaltzintli or Tlapali, red ochre and rendered animal fat paint. When this racial and cultural diaspora found themselves in the territories or lands where they could no longer access Tlahuistli or red ochre to make their Tlapaltzintli from, in its place, these displaced descendants used red pigment to paint their skin made from a wide varying range of new local sources ranging from Nochestli or cochineal, commonly known as carmine in tropical Mexico, achiotl or annatto seed in Central and South America, cinnabar or vermilion in the Mediterranean, Mesopotamia, the Levant, and the western coastal territories of the U.S., and saffron and alkanized turmeric in parts of India. Now, let us address the very specific type of hair worn by the men of this race's traditional descendants. Why do we do this, and when and where did this tradition begin? What is its significance to the Ejeja Tunaltealtlajame, or the race of the wind sun? This tradition, the creation of this sacred genethliac braid located at the back top crown of the head, directly over the parietal lobe of the brain of men, being kept sanctified, holy, and separate from all other hair on a male's head, begins in the second age by our clan's race's original patrilineal progenitor, whom we know as Sipach Tonaltzin. It is said in our old songs and our oldest oral history that in the second age of Ejeja Tonaltial, before any of the creatures or flora and fauna from this realm that you know as Earth had received the breath of life from Ometeotzin, the highest creative force of the cosmos, and any influence from the heavens of Topan, and was only a soul expression or manifestation from the mind of Tepoploanteuchtli, or the Demiurge, or Yadabaoth, as Western occultists and academics may have heard this force described as before. Our early patrilineal forefathers had evolved into humanoid from an ancient reptilian species of dog, whom had itself evolved from the serpents that had survived the cataclysm that had ended the first age of Ocelo Tonaltiao, and were in their early stages of human development with no tonal or consciousness of their own, no divine influence. When it is said that our race's second age clan's oldest patriarch, whom later became known as Sipach Tonaltzin, whose name meant reverent conscious crocodile, one day early before sunrise, our original patriarch witnessed a great opulent blue shining star he had never witnessed before, and shining forth from the center of this great opulent blue beaming star was a four-pointed directional cross, which we would later come to call the Nahui, or the Nahuitzintli, or the Nau Champa, which seemed to grow bigger and brighter in front of Sipach Tonaltzin's eyes, and then began spinning, whirling slowly in a counterclockwise direction. The legs of this four-point light cross began bending, leaving light trails behind them as the cross whirled slowly in a counterclockwise direction, creating the symbol that we call the Nau Ololin, the counterclockwise swastika. This whirling four-directional cross was said to spin faster and brighter until Sipach Tonaltzin was blinded by its opulent blue light. Even with his eyes closed, he could still see this whirling cross spinning so brightly, now red through the red blood vessels of his eyelids. It was too bright to open his eyes for some time. And then it is said when Sipach Tonaltzin was finally able to open his eyes, it was said standing there before him was a divine, shining woman who is said to have come from Patlan, the sky, from a place that we know as Tlahuizcalpan, a heavenly realm and abode known by the Romans as Venus, which during this age was the lowest of the heavenly realms of Topan. It is said that this divine shining woman from Tlahuizcalpan, according to our second age clans or history and songs, was known as Achtoichpochtzin, and by other modern Huastec dialect speaking clans as Oshomojo, whose name both means the first reverent maiden, or the first reverend woman, and was said to be the direct descendant avatar and daughter of a demigod or fourth dimensional being that we knew as Tlahuizcalpan Tzihuatzin, Reverend Lady of Venus, as well as Xochiquetzalitzin, which means reverent, beautiful, upstanding, or righteous flower, as well as Inantzin, or Inanna, literally meaning his reverent mother, referring to this demigod being the known mother of the black Tezcatlipoca, whom we know as Tepoploanteuxin, the demiurge responsible for the creation of the nine lower realms of the underworld of Xihonaomictlan and the initial creation of this middle realm of Temawanchan. Inantzin or Inanna or Xochiquetzal was also known by the Akkadians as Ishtar, the Romans as Venus, the Egyptians as Isis, the Greeks as Aphrodite, the Sumerians as Inanna, and by the Norse as Freya. It is said that this demigod Inantzin or Xochiquetzal, feeling pity for her forlorn bastard son's creation's lowly hopeless states and its humanoid patriarch, sent her own aspect to descend down into Temawanchan to connect this middle realm of Temawanchan with the heavens of Topan and creator by sending her own aspect to this middle realm through her daughter Achtoichpochtzin or Oshomoho, who the biblical scholars may know as Eve. It is said when our primary patrilineal patriarch, who had no consciousness of his own, no capability to speak and thus had no name yet, saw Achtoichpochtzin, he became so overcome by her opulence, radiance, and beauty that he fell to his knees and prostrated before her. It is said Achtoichpochtzin, seeing our ancient patriarch's courageous humility, piety, and strong heart, despite his own lowly state and the harsh condition of the realm he and his people had come to fruition in, she was stricken with love and compassion and amazement. It is said that as she stood there with our patriarch prostrating before her, she pierced the palm of her right hand with a thorn and placed the bloody palm of her right hand on the crown of our ancient patriarch's head. At the back top of his skull, where the parietal lobe is located that was facing her, and spoke the words, Shimonemi Shimoketsa Sipachtonaltzin, live, arise, reverent conscious crocodile. It is said at this very moment when Achtoichpochtzin touched her right bloody palm to the crown of our patriarch's head and spoke these words, she gave our patriarch Sipachtonaltzin and our people the Cuezcoyahualolli, the crown chakra, and our connection to creator through the sun, and the ability to receive divine influence or cognition from Tonaltiotzin, the highest fourth dimensional being and divine sun portal. When Sipachtonaltzin arose, he stood fully upright now with full consciousness, but still was unable to feel her, speak to her, or to truly see her. It is said then, after Sipachtonaltzin stood, Achtoichpochtzin curled her right hand's middle finger down to her bloody palm, and with the blood on the tip of her right middle finger, drew the Nahuitzintli, or now Champa, the sacred sigil of Venus, the four-directional cross on the chest of Sipachtonaltzin, directly over his heart, which opened Sipachtonaltzin's Yoloteoashichtli, or heart portal, wide open, further connecting Sipachtonaltzin and our people to the soul of Creator through the soul of Mother Earth, but only in the feminine way, which gave him and our people the capability to feel compassion, love, empathy, and sympathy for the first time in our race's history. Achtoichpochtzin then curled her right hand's ring finger down to her bloody palm, and with the blood on the tip of her right ring finger, drew the trails on the ends of the four directional legs of the Nahuitzintli, or the Naujampa, the sacred sigil of Venus, the four directional cross, signifying the spinning of the Nahuitzintli in the sacred counterclockwise direction, creating the symbol and sigil known as the Nau Ololin, the counterclockwise whirling swastika, which was said to open Sipachtonaltzin's Yoloteoashichli, or heart chakra, even wider, but now as well in the masculine way, which gave him and our people the capability to feel balance and peace within our hearts and an impulse for reconnection with the all, or oneness and wholeness. Achto Ichpochtzin then curled her right hand's ring finger once again down into her bloody palm, and with the blood on the tip of her right ring finger, drew a horizontal line onto the middle point center of Sipachtonaltzin's throat, giving him and our people the feminine hemisphere of the Toskiteoashichtli, the throat chakra, connecting our people to Creator through the feminine hemisphere of the Venus portal, through which the divine feminine Venus aspect of Creator may flow through into him, associated with beauty and knowledge and expression, causing Sipachtonaltzin to burst out into unintelligible tones and harmony, where the tradition of our people's unintelligible harmonic verses and our traditional songs come from. Achto Ichpochtzin, or Osho Mochotzin, then curled her right hand's ring finger for the last time down into her bloody palm, and with the blood on the tip of her right ring finger, drew a vertical line crossing at the very center of the horizontal line on Sipachtonaltzin's throat, creating the Nahuitzintli, or four-point Naohampa Venus cross, which opened up the masculine side of this portal, thus giving Sipachtonaltzin and our people a properly balanced Toskiteoashichtli, or throat chakra, allowing as well the divine masculine Venus aspect of Creator, which is wisdom, to flow into him through this portal. At which time, Sipachtonaltzin began to speak calmly and intelligibly, using his ability to speak to quietly and calmly praise
Achto Ichpochtzin.
This is where the Nahuatlatoli language is supposed to have originated from, and the reason for its etymology and name. But it is said that even now, with all of what had been given, Sipachtonaltzin could still not yet truly see Achto Ichpochtzin. So Achto Ichpochtzin then curled her right pinky finger down onto her bloody palm, and with the tip of her right pinky finger, touched the center point of Sipachtonaltzin's forehead brow line directly over his pituitary gland, which gave Sipachtonaltzin and our people the masculine hemisphere of the Teoistelo-Teoashichtli, or the spirit eye or third eye portal, connecting Sipachtonaltzin and our people to Creator through the masculine side of Mercury, the portal through which the divine masculine Mercury aspect of Creator may flow through into him. Instantly, Sipachtonaltzin saw Achto Ichpochtzin more clearly and became filled with romantic love and a powerful urge to want to protect and safeguard her and unify with her and marry with her and create with her. But he could still not yet fully clearly see her. So Achto Ichpochtzin then dipped her right pinky finger for the last time into her bloody right palm, and about a fingertip's distance directly above the bloody dot she left at the center of Sipachtonaltzin's brow line, she placed her bloody tipped right pinky and dragged it upwards, making a straight line upwards directly over Sipachtonaltzin's pineal gland, which then gave Sipachtonaltzin and our people the feminine hemisphere of the Teoistelo-Teoashichtli, or spirit eye or third eye chakra, properly calibrating this portal. So now the divine masculine and divine feminine Mercury aspect of Creator could influence and flow into Sipachtonaltzin and our people. It is said now Sipachtonaltzin could truly and holistically see Osho Mochotzin in her entirety, perceiving Achto Ichpochtzin not just as a beautiful, divine, opulent, yet vulnerable physical woman whom he sought to protect, nourish, care for, and create with, but now witness Achto Ichpochtzin from the spirit or non-physical, supersensible realm of perception, and saw Achtoichpochtzin as well as the very avatar of Tlahuitzcalpantzihuatzin and Xochiquetzaltzin, Lady Venus, and as further the powerful direct expression of Omecihuatzin, the primary divine feminine aspect of creator that dwells in the second highest realm of the 13 heavens of Topan, and even further as the eternal Teyotl, from which all of thought, form, awareness, and manifestation flow from, through, and as. And Sipachtonaltzin could as well see Achtoichpochtzin in her most raw and personal form, as simply Theolia, an eternal soul, neither distinctly masculine or feminine, on its ever shape-shifting, ever form-changing, morphogenic, perilous journey back towards reunion with Source and Wholeness. It is said that when Sipachtonaltzin became a true human being, now fully aware and fully conscious, that he plucked out all of the hair of his body, face, and head, besides the area of hair that the palm of Achtoichpochtzin's bloody palm had touched, which was a portion of hair that grew from the scalp directly over his parietal lobe on the crown or back top of his head. Sipachtonaltzin then plunged himself in the center meeting point of the Anahuatoyatzitzin, the sacred four rivers of Anahuac or Pangea or Eden, four times, washing himself clean. And when he arose from out of the waters of the Anahuatoyatzitzin, after the fourth plunge, it is said that Sipachtonaltzin was reborn anew. This is where the origin of the Second Age's original baptismal tradition and customs comes from. Sipachtonaltzin then, with tlapaltzintli or red ochre paint made from Sipach Chihuahuacayotl, crocodile oil taken from the reverent crocodile in the east, the Nahual of Tonaltzin Tlaltzin, Mother Earth, and the Tlauteshintli, made from the red ochre powder gathered in the west, Sipachtonaltzin marked himself with the same markings that Achtoichpochtzin had put on him with her blood. First, the red four-point counterclockwise whirling Venus cross, known as the Nahuololin or swastika, over his heart, and then the red Nahuitzintli or Nahuhampa four-point Venus cross on his throat, then a single red dot on the center of his brow line, and a fingertips width above a red line stretching straight upwards, and lastly a red circle around the portion of hair kept on the crown of his head that Achtoichpochtzin had touched, where his piochtli or scalplock braid would be forever kept separate and sanctified from all other hair on his head. He then adopted the sigil of Venus, the Nahui or Nahuitzintli or the Nahuhampa, the four-point directional cross of Venus, and its generative counterclockwise whirling counterpart, the Nahuololi, as his Tlahuitzintli, his personal sacred sigils, and then pledged four times in each of the four sacred directions, beginning and ending, facing east towards Venus, that the men of his lineage from this day forward would keep sanctified the holy hair of their Cuezco, or the crown of their head, where Sipachtonaltzin was touched by the bloody hand of Achtoichpochtzin, separate from all other hair on their head, and oathed the patrilineal line of his descendants to carry the burden of the piochtli or genitlic scalplock braid, and with it the oath that the men of his lineage would always care for and protect the divine feminine aspect of Venus and the matrilineage that had sacrificed itself by descending from the heavenly abode of Tlahuizcalpan down below to this lower realm to give him and his lowly race of serpents and this realm the breath of life from creator and a tether, a ladder to the heavens of Topan. Sipachtonaltzin, now fully conscious, divinely influenced, and a noble upright human male, was found desirable and worthy by Achtoichpochtzin, who then took him as her mate, and they were fruitful and multiplied. And Achtoichpochtzin and her female descendants then became the divine Rh-negative matrilineal line of the race of the Second Age. and Sipachtonaltzin and his male descendants became the serpent Rh-negative patrilineoline of the race of the Second Age, and their descendants became the original clans of the Ejeja Tonaltiautlajame, the people of the Wind Sun, the race of the Second Age, the Nahua, the keepers of the four-point Venus cross. And from this day forth, the male descendants of the Ejeja Tonaltiautlajame, the race of the Wind Sun of the Second Age, kept the sacred custom and tradition of the Piochtli or Temilot or Genitlek scalplock braid, receiving this braid after all of the other hair of a male child's head had been shaved off of at the age of 1 year old, after the skull of a male child had fully closed, in a ceremony that we call the Piochtzin Ilpia Tlalistzintli, the reverent binding of the holy scalplock braid, keeping this braid from 1 year of age until his death, reverent and sanctified from all other hair on his head, and considered this genitlik braid as the core of a traditional male's spirituality, spiritual existence, ceremonial life, and a male's umbilical cord to the divine. And from this day on, our people's prayers were always given facing east towards the morning star, Venus. The doors of our ewahali or skin houses or tlalchali or earth houses or the huayahuaochali longhouses always faced east towards Venus, for the day when our matrilineal matriarch Ashto Ichpochtzin's people from the sky, the people from Tlahuizhalpan, return. And all of our ceremonies always begin in the eastern direction and end in the eastern direction, moving counterclockwise. And as well, from this point on, the race of the Second Age carried and adorned themselves in all of their vestments, including their skin, with the Tlahuistli, the sigil of our patriarch given to him by Achto Ichpochtzin, the four-pointed cross of Venus, the Nahuitzintli or Naohampa, and its counterclockwise whirling counterpart, the Naololin. And because of this, became known as the Nahuake, the Nahuatlajame, the Nahuaja, or Nahua, meaning the keepers or those associated with the four-pointed cross and the sacred number four. This is also where the root of both the etymology and the stories of the Nahuali sorcerers, Nahua or Naga serpent race of sorcerers in Aztec, Toltec, Mexica, Maya, Inca, Muskogean, Iroquoian, Algonquin, Hopi, Hawaiian, Maori, and Polynesian, Olmeca, Aryan, Vedic, Dravidian, Celtic, Southeast Asian, Egyptian, Kemetic, and African oral history and perceived mythology come from. Now it is said when Sipachtonaltzin died that his soul became the divine archetype known as Xipetotexin, the flayed one, or he whom sheds his skin, the divine archetype of rebirth and renewal that replaced one of the four divine archetypes, Ehechatzin, the reverent wind, the divine archetype of the unseen force of change, and became one of the primary four cardinal archetypes of Ometeyotzin that dwell in the second to highest 12th realm of the heavens of Topan that we call Ilhuichat Teteyochan. The Piochtli or Temilot genitlik braid worn with a fully shorn head was continued by the Second Age clan's descendants whom had become the royal priest caste of ancient Aztlan, and was continued by the clans of their descendants, while the Second Age clans whom had became the military nobility of Aztlan, such as the Cuachique, wore the shorn head with the Piochtli as well, but more commonly with a strip of hair that began at the top of their scalp locks and ended halfway to three quarters towards the front of the top of their heads, and was spiked upwards with red tlalpatzintli grease paint. This crest was called the Huachichichtli and was mimicking the red tall comb of the Huanajatl rooster, the red jungle fowl of ancient Aztlan, not the crest of the Huauchenche woodpecker, or the crest of the Chiltotot, red cardinal, whom are not known for their warrior culture and lifestyle and incredible, fearless, and ferocious fighting capabilities, unlike the male Huanahatl, or the red jungle fowl rooster, who very much so is. Now, the clans of heavily mixed second and third age raced peoples still kept the burden, the tradition, and rites of the Piochtli Genithliac braid, but instead of continuing to pluck out all of the hair on their heads besides the Piochtli after the age of one, instead adopted the Huananahatzontli, also known as the Huatepolzontli, which was a mushroom or penis head-shaped haircut, which was kept short so it could be easily distinguishable from the hair of the Piochtli or scalplock braid that had been preserved from a male scalplock binding ceremony which occurred one solar year after his birth. Another variant worn by this same diaspora was the Ometzonilpili, which was the Piochtli braid preserved from the age of 1 year old, and then the rest of the hair grown back, remaining uncut, but kept separate from the Piochtli in two long braids made from the hair split down the center of the top and back of the head below the Piochtli. Another variant of the Ometzonilpili was a large Piochtli or scalp lock that was made up of all of the hair of the back of the head, braided into a single large Piochtli braid similar to the Chinese Bianzi, and the leftover hair on the temples and top of the head were then split down the center and braided into two smaller braids. Now, in this third age and new lands that this race of the second age found themselves on when they left Chicomoztoc, the inner earth, and migrated out onto the surface world into Aztlan with their bodies painted in the red tlapatzintli ochre paint, they found that a new race of early biped humanoid was already present on these islands, whose genesis into bipedal Homo sapien had occurred on these islands of Aztlan. This was the reverent race of the third age, the Ak Tonaltiaotlajame, the race of the water sun. The aboriginal people of Aztlan or Atlantis, also known as the Osomatlajame, the monkey people, because they were said to have evolved into bipedal Homo sapien from the Osomatzintli, the reverent monkeys whom had survived on these string of islands through the global cataclysm that had ended the second age by way of a great solar wind and shifting of lands, whom had then slowly evolved into the bipedal humanoid of Aztlan or Atlantis in the third age, creating the first race of iron-blooded primate evolved human beings whom we knew as the Atl-Tonal-Teotlajame, the race of the water sun, the race of the third age whom our second age clans often referred to as the Kwaitlil-Tsinha, the reverent black-headed or black-haired people who modern Western academics referred to as the Neanderthal. And because this race's genesis had occurred on the surface of the earth during this third age, under this new third age's sun, the Atl-Tonal-Teotlajame, the race of the third age, the aboriginal population of Aztlan, had to develop a certain and specific physiological adaptation unique to that location and age's solar and atmospheric conditions, which created and produced, among other specific physiological phenotypical traits, the melanin, known today as brown eumelanin, which creates dark black hair, brown skin, and honey brown to dark brown eyes, and phenotypical features specific to and seen exemplified by the Asiatic Rh negative haplogroup R diaspora and phenotype still present most largely among populations in modern-day South Asia, East Asia, Southeast Asia, India, North America, Central and South America, Mexico, China, Japan, the Middle East, Arabia, Central Asia, Eastern Europe, Micronesia, Polynesia, Alaska, and Siberia. It is well said that there were many diasporas within this Third Ages race Rh-positive haplogroup R, who between the time at the end of the third age and the beginning of the fourth age, whose skin turned black as their hair, along with many animals, including the group of early hominid, whom would later become the black-skinned phenotype and counterpart to to the white skin phenotype and diaspora of the race of the fourth age of Cro-Magnon. It is well said that not only did the skin of these diasporas of the race of the third age turn black, having to epigenetically mutate to produce a more strong type of melanin, scholars refer to as black eumelanin, to block, bind with, and filter out the overwhelming, harmful amount of UV radiation coming from the sun during this pan-generational solar event that occurred through the end of the third age and into the beginning of the fourth age, close to 55,000 years ago on the surface of the earth, affecting most extremely certain latitudes, locations, and ley lines. It is said as well that their hair turned thicker, fuller, and spiraled into varying degrees of kinky or woolly to help generate a more powerful native electromagnetic field to help protect this diaspora from the solar radiation. This diaspora's nostrils is well widened to a degree to adapt to the low amount of oxygen in the certain locations, latitudes, and ley lines on the surface of the earth where this solar event impacted most extremely, where there was a depleted atmosphere and thus much less oxygen available. Examples of descendants of this very special and sacred specific third age races, black-skinned, kinky-haired, and wide-nostril diaspora or phenotype still live on as the haplogroup R populations, most commonly found in Australasia, Papua New Guinea, southern India, Melanesia, Malaysia, Polynesia, Australia, the Middle East, New Caledonia, but as well, according to various people's oral history, small diasporas of this phenotype and haplogroup were said to be present as well in Japan and parts of North, Central, and South America, and even in the British Isles. In fact, it is said that the tall, fair-skinned, copper-haired diaspora, the half-giant, half-second-age Atlantean race of refugees of the Olmeca Empire, when they arrived on some of the southwestern or Australasian islands of the Pacific, like that of New Zealand, there was already a small population present who were described as small, round-faced, black-skinned, and kinky-haired people who are said to be the remnants of this very diaspora of the Third Age race of the Osomatlachame, whose skin had gone from brown to black, just like the black crow, the black raven, the black jaguar, the black serpents, the black bears, the black primates, the black wolves, the black foxes, and all other animals and people that had to develop this biochemical compound and variant of melanin, known as black eumelanin, because they had remained unsheltered on the surface of the earth during the time between the end of the third age and the beginning of the fourth age, when there was a solar event that triggered this very specific epigenetic mutation. It is said that on some of the islands where the clans of the copper-blooded, half-breed giant, and second-age-blooded mid landed, they fell in love with some of the black-skinned, round-faced third-age women whom lived there and chose to either stay and live with their people, or some of the women chose to leave with them as their wives, and these two groups' blood became mixed. This is the reason why on some of the Australasian islands you see indigenous third-age peoples from haplogroup R with black eumelanin-saturated skin, and yet with copper or gold hair and blue, hazel, or green eyes and Denisovan blood. And why, on most of the Polynesian islands, you see Polynesians with Australasian features, kinky hair and wide noses, and very dark skin. It is said a similar occurrence as this happened on the islands of Japan, when another large group of half-giant, half-second-age diaspora fled the Proto-Aryan, Proto-Sumerian, Proto-Semitic empires of the Levant, the bloodlines whom are brought on the arcs of the Atlantean king Nota or Tzihuactitlan, whom after so many generations during the period of the fourth age had chose to flee the empires and migrated east from the Levant into Central Asia, intermingling with the race of the fourth age present in that territory, creating the Proto-Mongolian or Central Asian diaspora. And another group who did not settle in the area continued migrating through Central Asia and Mongolia into the Pacific coast of northern China, and then to the southern Pacific coast of modern-day Russia, where one group then migrated north, settling in Siberia, and another group migrated south into the Strait of Tartary by canoe, then from there migrated south into the La Perouse Strait, into modern-day Hokkaido, Japan, where this diaspora split again. One group was said to have then traveled from Hokkaido through the Kuril Islands by canoe into the Kamchatka Peninsula, where one large group traveled north, settling into Siberia, while another group left from the east coast of the Kamchatka Peninsula and island hopped through the string of the Aleutian Islands, island by canoe, east into the Alaskan Peninsula, where this group then migrated further inland and settled in the lands between the Arctic and Pacific Ocean in modern-day inland Alaska and western Canada, where they intermingled with the local Fourth Age indigenous populations of the area and became the Athabascan language-speaking peoples of the Na Dene between the time of somewhere between the end of the Fourth Age and the beginning of the Fifth Age, whose southern migrating descendants, thousands of years later, became the Nde and the Dene, the Apache and the Navajo of the Southwest Territories of America. The other group whom arrived in Hokkaido, Japan, is said to have then migrated further south, where they then intermingled with the people who were already there, remnants of a small population of round-faced, black-skinned, kinky-haired people who are said to be remnants of the diaspora of the members of the Third Age race whose ancestors on this island's skin had turned from brown to black because they had remained unsheltered on the surface of the earth during the time between the end of the Third Age and the beginning of the Fourth Age when there was a solar event. These two groups intermingled and their descendants became the foundationary lineages of the Ainu people of pre-dynastic Japan. Now, back to the Polynesian islands. It is said that in the Fifth Age, hundreds of generations later, fleets of exploratory naval ships and naval military nobility of mixed Third Age and distant Second Age lineage and their wives and families and clans, whom were the descendants of the empire that Atlantean king Melahuac-Tlantawantzin or Manu had established in southern India and Southeast Asia between 10,000 to 2,000 years ago, began in waves landing or commuting through the islands of the Pacific on their way back and forth to Central and South America, and began interloping and synthesizing with the tall, red-painted, swirling tattooed, fair-skinned, copper-haired, light-eyed indigenous populations, as well as the black-skinned, brown-eyed, round-faced, kinky-haired peoples of the islands of the Pacific. This reunion and union, this cultural genetic synthesis that occurred in the Pacific Islands, is what created the descendants that would make up the modern, powerful Pacific Islander and Polynesian peoples, the Samoans, the Tongans, the Niueans, the Cook Island Maori, the Tahitian Maori, the Hawaiian Maoli, the Marquesans, and the New Zealand Maori. And this is the reason for their very complex genetic makeup. Now, the Kinamessin Waitlachame, the race of the giants, where did they come from? And what is the reason for their otherworldly appearance and stature? It is said that during the first age that we call Ocelo Tonalteau, the jaguar or predator sun, during the time known to modern man as the age of the dinosaurs, there was once again a different sun. And this first age's sun of Ocelo Tonalteau was even dimmer than the sun of the second age. And the race who arrived here during the first age is known to have come from the inner earth. This was the race of the first age, whom we know as the Ocelo Tonalteautlachame, the predator sun people, or the Kinametsin Waitlachame race of giants. This race is said to have evolved from a reptilian lineage, like the race of the second age, but from an inner earth reptile that far predated the reptiles of the surface of the earth, ages before the genesis of the primates of the third age, and because of this, just like the race of the second age, did not have iron-based Rh-positive blood, but had copper-based serpent or Rh-negative blood, but from an ancient reptilian lineage, not from the surface of the earth. And because these people had evolved from an ancient inner earth reptilian strata, And because this race's bipedal and humanoid genesis began within the inner earth and not on the surface of the earth, and during an age with a much dimmer sun, it is said that this race of giants were as large as the megaflora and megafauna of this first age, whose heads were taller than the tops of the pine trees in Third Age Aztlan, and whom had absolutely no form of melanin in their skin, and who are genetically responsible for the genetic trait modern scholars refer to as leucism, not albinism, but leucism, which causes snow white skin, snow white hair, and ice blue eyes, and an extreme susceptibility and vulnerability for extreme cellular damage
and irradiation
caused from any slight exposure to sunlight. This is the race whom cultures around the world knew as the Anunnaki, the Anunnagi, the Daityas, the Hyperboreans, the Laestrogonians, the Siteca, the Ishpolini, the Gentali, the Fomorians, the Rephaim, the Jotun, and many more, making up the central figures in the perceived legends and myths of all ancient antediluvian peoples and cultures worldwide. It is said that near the end of this second age, this race of giants began in the darkness of night after the sun had gone down, sending a small number of men from their inner earth domain through cave systems up into the surface of the earth to kidnap entire villages of Second Age peoples in Anahuac and bring them down into the inner earth to their domain, where they would eat the men and inseminate the copper-blooded women of the race of the Second Age to create the later albino and ginger phenotypes of smaller red-haired giants who were able to walk the earth in the sun, and who colonized Aztlan or Atlantis in the Third Age of Atl-Tunaltiau and became the giant god-kings of Aztlan and the foundation of the royal or kingship bloodlines on the surface of the earth.
As you can.